Fucking love that song. If you were at the Gladstone last Friday, like, that was an amazing show. You guys tore the roof apart.
It was a lot of fun.
It was a lot of fun. We had some problems, but
you know who else had a problem? You know who else has problems?
Who's got problems, Jay?
If you're an elderly fan and you go to a racetrack, you're gonna have to relieve yourself at one point.
Dude, look at that loops in the bottom corner. Look at that. 27, 37, 244,000, 47, 57. It's getting watched tens of times at right now. In the past.
So zoom in.
He's just taking a piss. What's the problem? Is it just because it's funny?
Well, it's because it's Niki Lauda.
Oh, okay. Why does he not do that? Is that?
Well, I think it's you uphold certain drivers to a high degree of expectations, especially veteran drivers like Lauda. I mean, he had a movie made.
He had a movie.
About him.
Yeah.
That's true. He drove against Thor.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, and won or something. Yeah. Sometimes.
Look at the loops.
I don't
want to
drive. It's raining.
This has been watched like 1,000 times since we started the show.
Oh, that's jokes. Oh. But yeah, this picture has.
Wait, who's this guy? Just some random.
Oh, that's Ted Kravitz.
Ted Kravitz.
Yeah, he's this guy F1 pit lane reporter. He's good. He's a good guy. He does a good analysis.
He's got a keen eye.
Boom. That's where I'm going to keep it.
He's got a Sky segment called Ted's Notebook.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So he has a notebook.
Oh, that's cool.
Does some doodles and picks up on all the small stuff that everybody else misses.
So, Yes, actually, last week we started a contest that we were very excited about because we got these invitations for Racing For Me. If you don't know what Racing For Me is, I'm not going to say it. then you probably don't want these invites. But we had some contest entries, and basically the last week's contest was to send us your rendition of one of the F1 tracks, past, present, or future. We got some pretty good ones, but definitely.
Thank you, Steve Church.
Yes, thank you, Steve Church, for this one here, Mike. If you want to.
Oh, sorry.
Hit
hold
that.
On. Let me.
Round one.
Oh, I've already messed this all up.
Yeah, right here.
Tab two. Yeah. Round one, Steve Church. You are our runner-up.
Yeah.
Ooh. Sorry to say, man. Somebody beat you, but that was incredible. I laughed really hard when I saw that.
I love this because it's Steve Church. Are you Canadian? If you're not, you get it, man. That's
Salut, Gilles.
Yeah, that is the Canadian Grand Prix circuit. And then if you read here in the small print, he says it's a 2014 spec car because it has a weird nose. So
and the new tires.
Yeah.
Oh,
man. Good job. I mean, I really like that. I thought that this was going to be hard to beat. And I thought that nobody was going to come up with something better. But alas, they did.
Hold on. If this was a car,
Steve
I would
Harrison.
Drive it.
What?
If this was a car, I would drive it.
Yeah. But no. We have to say
right here.
Yes.
You are a winner, man.
You are our winner. Harrison Logan.
Welcome to RFM.
Yeah. Give it up to Harrison Logan.
Go. Dude, I want one of these shirts.
Yeah, I do.
This guy fucking made this.
Scroll down, man. You can see his whole development process.
That's what I'm doing right here.
For anybody listening,
he's got
you
the gloves
see,
on and everything. Look at that.
If you want to see all the entries, check out our Twitter at Flat Out Theater. You can
cool.
see all the
Look
entries.
At that.
Yeah.
That's the cool little stencil.
Yeah.
It's like he's got a mask and gloves on.
This guy went full out.
Safe the iron.
Yeah.
He's got the same table as us there.
So.
Yeah, I think he got it at Walmart.
Yeah. How much was it? $20 or something?
Yeah, it was like 40.
Mm-hmm. Look at this. This dude wore his shirt to the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
To go watch the Super Bowl.
Yeah. So over the week, on Sunday, I guess he wore it. To the amazement of his friends, I'm sure.
He's like, what are you wearing? Yeah, how come you're not like a Seahawks or Patriots fan right now?
No. Jeez, but hey, he was spreading the F1 love.
He was.
Dude, you're a number one fan.
Yeah.
Check your email this afternoon.
Yeah. Or yeah, I mean, yeah. I guess, no, he sent us his entry through Facebook. So
yeah.
Check your Facebook. We're going to send you the invite code. Basically, what you got to do with that invite code is copy and paste it on the Racing For Me front page. Like, just say that you're going to register. And it's one of the fields is going to ask you for an invite code. Just put it in and you're in. You're in. Welcome.
Congratulations.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Look at this fucking shirt, man. Space themed. Yes.
I love it. I want it.
Yeah.
And
thank Steve, you, Harrison.
Yeah.
Dude, if you want to make us three more shirts,
I will wear it every day of my life.
Harrison, Logan, you win.
Name your price.
Yeah. And look at him. Yeah, he's there at the bar while watching the game or something. This is amazing.
Yeah, this is fantastic.
That's fucking great.
Harrison, you are the man.
All right, everybody. Welcome to the Flat Out Fever podcast.
We talk about F1 stuff and guys with receding hairlines wearing shirts that we like. All right. And I'm Jay.
Danny over here.
And I'm Michael.
And we're going to start talking about something that Danny wants to talk about.
We're going to talk about some sparks. The sparks.
Hold on a minute.
Yeah, that's a plan. There you go. So this is the type of shit that was happening through the 80s. You see this shit? Like sometimes showers of sparks.
So what you're saying is we need to bring this back.
Well,
some people
we need to make
say
it more dangerous.
What I'm saying is we don't have a choice. It's back. It is back. Mm. It is back this year. Well, let's go to the origin of this though, because after World War II, up into the 50s, they all had these cigar-shaped cars with big wheels on them. They were high off the ground. A lot of the old tracks were based on World War II.
Oh, really?
Airports and stuff, like really bumpy.
Yeah, like sometimes
1950s
like,
asphalt.
Yeah, sometimes what they would call an F1 track would be the perimeter road around an airfield.
Oh,
and even,
crazy!
Even modern tracks like Silverstone
was basically that. It started as
built
that
on a RAF airfield during the war. So yeah, these cars, they had like really high ride, really bouncy suspensions because
the
roads were shit.
Be,
yeah,
right, okay.
Yeah, they were like
now they're all sort of flat and smooth, like a
they
Brazilian
make it with
wax.
A special tarmac.
Oh yeah, like after the into the 60s when they started throwing wings on
that
cars.
Was for you.
Yeah, into the 60s they started throwing wings on cars and adding downforce. Like really, the soft suspension was to keep the tires stuck to the ground so the car wouldn't bounce and skip.
Oh, okay, I see.
But with the wings, when they brought downforce into the later 60s,
yeah,
they were able to stiffen up the suspension a lot. And then into the early 70s, when the ground effect was discovered.
Right.
They wanted to bring the cars as low to the ground as possible, without actually touching the ground, but as low to the ground as possible. So
now, weird question, but like, was there like a group or sect of people that was like, oh, I don't want all this downforce. I miss the suspension. I want the ground tires.
Enzo Ferrari very famously has been was quoted at one point saying that aerodynamics were for people who couldn't build engines. But I mean, he was an old school guy, and at that transition period, aerodynamics and these kind of, you know, ground effects and whatever, it was an unproven thing. But then shortly after he said that, I think the Lotus came and started like winning all the races. So he quickly ate those words right up in his morning pasta, I'm sure.
They had cars pasta.
Breakfast pasta. But yeah, they had these cars that had, they had basically like side skirts, like you'd see on a modern car, but they're sort of like mounted on springs so that as the cars would drive, they would be forced down.
Right.
And these side skirts would kind of just like rub on the ground. They just like had basically their own suspension and basically seal the air under the car. Then in 81, it was getting out of hand and they mandated a minimum 6-inch ride clearance on the cars.
Mm.
So the first team, I think, that came up with an automatic ride height switch was Brabham.
Brabham, okay, yeah.
Yeah, Brabham had I think it was a hydraulic switch that at a certain speed, the suspension would just drop.
Mm-hmm.
And then other teams came up with, like as fast as they could, they came up with basically like a switch inside the car. Like, they came around a corner, hit a straight, and boom, they would hit this switch. The car would lower down.
Oh,
they come
crazy
to the corners and raise the car back up. So it started
This Williams, actually, I think it's like the FW, whatever, I don't know. But this Williams here was famous because it had an electronic system throughout the car that kept the entire car, no matter what happened, no matter the lateral loads, no matter the corner, it was only 4 millimeters off the ground at all times.
This is getting a bit ahead, though. This was in, I think, 93.
Yeah, 93.
It's arguably still, even though it was like 20, 22 years
ago. Immediately got banned, obviously. Yeah.
So it's like, well, that's unfair.
Yeah.
Arguably still, though, the most advanced car with the most advanced suspension
for its
system
time.
That
oh,
there
wow.
was.
Yeah.
No, not even for its time. There's,
even right now, it's pretty.
Basically, like, these cars have wings, right? And they were, like, tilting, like, the car into the corner was tilting into the corner, basically like flying.
Oh wow!
Really low to the ground.
That's cool. Mm-hmm.
So anyway, these 6 centimeter ride height lasted for only 2 years because they started building basically like wings and diffusers and channels under the car to funnel the air more efficiently.
Mm-hmm.
And in 83, it was mandated from the back of the front tires to the front of the back tires, the whole bottom of the car had to be completely flat. So it had to be completely flat. They banned the undercar wings. It was getting out of control. Right. And
is that where the barge boards come in then? Like the wooden planks.
That came after Imola in 94.
Oh,
so after these, Senna. This was in, I think, 83. Mm-hmm. And then from 83 into the early 90s, teams were developing automatic suspensions, basically, that were like tilting all over the place.
Jeez.
Actually,
active suspensions.
If you saw the cars,
this
sitting,
is where the spark started.
Yeah.
If you saw
the cars like
into
sitting
the early,
in the pits,
early to mid '80s is when this started.
Like when this car was sitting in the pits because it had that active suspension or whatever, it looked like a beast, like just like prowling, like because it wouldn't move automatically like this.
Yeah.
Like it would just like it would lift and then it come down. It would basically look like a beast like breathing. It was pretty cool.
Yeah, wow. Yeah, they could like
more of that
doing
please.
A demo. If this is the car flat, you could see it. They would like fully automatic. So anyways, into the early 80s, these teams came up with active suspensions that were computer controlled, getting crazy. And this is where the spark started because they wanted to protect. They started building with carbon fiber and fiberglass and shit like that. These cars, which is really brittle if you scrape it on the ground at 300 kilometers an hour.
Mm-hmm.
So they threw these titanium blocks under the corners of the wings, under the back diffuser, to protect the bottom of the car.
And what that came to be in the middle of the race was these fantastic showers and showers of sparks as the titanium hit the road. And really, it was all quite harmless. Like I don't think they ever hurt anybody. Mm-hmm. They didn't get banned because of safety reasons. They got banned because the technology moved forward.
Because in 1994, the San Marino Grand Prix
Senna.
In Imola, Senna is the guy who's remembered. He died during the race. He was the famous dude. But two men died that weekend.
Yeah, Roland Ratzenberger?
Yeah, Ratzenberger died in qualifying that weekend. And Ayrton Senna died during the race. And both guys died by their cars bottoming out because it was getting like so out of control that they were running them like millimeters off the ground and hitting the floor.
Right.
Basically that the tires are coming off the ground.
Well, there's this whole conspiracy that maybe the Senna's William failed because of the steering column. But anyway,
there's a conspiracy. Yeah, yeah. But more or less these guys hit the ground, lost control and couldn't stop. And then this one, the rules completely changed. It's like it completely
changed. I mean, they changed a lot in the benefit of safety, and since then, since Senna, nobody has died in Formula One.
Nobody's died.
Yeah,
because of these 94. Wooden planks. So if you go back one picture here, they started off until this year. See those triangles there?
Yeah.
So let's just break down this plank. The plank is 300 millimeters wide, 30 centimeters wide, with a 2 millimeter. There's a bit of tolerance on the width, 2 millimeters. Starts from 33 centimeters behind the front wheels to the back wheels. And those holes there are 6 pre-cut 5 centimeter holes. This board starts at the beginning of the race at 10 millimeters thick, 1 centimeter. And they put these steel blocks basically to the 5 points is where the board is measured at the end of the race. So if that board is any less than 9 millimeters after a race,
the car gets disqualified.
You get disqualified.
Holy shit.
This is too. It basically leaves it up to the team to be safe. keep your car from scraping the ground. And then these are, I don't know. I don't think there's any rule about what type of wood.
But the FIA provides them, so they're all the same. All the cars have the same planks.
I don't think the FIA provides these.
No?
No, because there are different. Some teams use like an MDF. Some use laminated beech wood, I saw. Oh, it has to have a specific gravity between 1.3 and 1.45 if you want to get crazy technical. But these skid blocks have been made out of steel since 1994. Until
these things here?
Yeah.
Okay.
So those are the skid blocks. You see a different type over there. Teams can basically put whatever type of skid blocks they want.
Oh, I see.
That protects their board from getting too worn out around the holes.
Okay.
Where the measurements are going to happen, right?
Which seems like a loophole, crazy. But whatever. But in the past few years, and I think in the last 2 years...
Because these are different. Like, these are different sizes, different shapes.
Yeah. So those skid blocks are outside the rules. You can... I believe they can be like whatever size or shape you want. But until this year. So these have flown off sometimes. You see how there's like three screws in it in a piece of wood?
Yeah.
You can imagine if you hit something with an edge going 300, it could fly off, which has happened. I don't think anyone's ever been hit by one of these, but they've caused flat tires, et cetera, et cetera. Shit. They're heavy. So last year at the Austrian Grand Prix, they had Raikkonen at Ferrari and Rosberg at Mercedes. Mm. For the first practice, they replaced those. See, at the time, I think it was maybe the Sky announcers that caused this rumor that they were testing this for the spectacle effect. If you go back,
right.
If you go back to the other picture there, you see the sparks showering out.
Yeah, that's just the next one over.
Yeah, to the right there. Yeah, this is more or less what you saw at Austin. Last year.
Oh, okay.
But I don't know, people called it artificial or whatever.
I'm all right with that.
But
it's like wrestling and MMA.
Yeah, there's gonna be a bit of sizzazz.
I just want to see a tombstone.
I don't know. According to Charlie Whiting, though, there are real safety reasons for this. Titanium's about two and a half times lighter and wears about that much faster than steel.
Oh, shit.
So if these pieces fly off, they cause less damage. Mm. They wear faster, hence the sparks. And they cause sparks, which some people really like.
Yeah, like me.
I love the sparks. I would love to see like F1 coming back to sparks, but I don't know how I feel at the end of the day.
Yeah,
if it's just artificially put there for the reason of spectacle. Even though I do applaud it, I think it would look kick-ass. It would still feel artificial. But hey, I'm pretty sure I used to say the same thing about DRS, and DRS is pretty sweet.
Yeah, DRS has worked out. They've balanced that shit out.
Yeah.
But yeah, whatever. These sparks, according to Charlie Whiting, they're not fully artificial. I think it was really Brundle last year during the practice was harping on it, saying it was people wanted the spectacle. Mm-hmm. So whether or not they came up with the two safety reasons afterwards,
right,
or whether that was the main purpose and Sky... started the rumor, who knows? But sparks this year. You've seen him at practice. Seen him on Sunday. Saw him yesterday.
Yeah.
Sparks are here now.
Sparks are a good thing. So is higher brake horsepower. And so is bigger tires. We applaud those changes. And we really, really look forward to when they do come into play.
Let's talk about Jerez, though.
Jerez de la Frontera. Jerez de la Frontera es un pueblo en España.
They're real Spanish.
This guy here?
No. But we can start with them. We can start with them.
Okay, Mike,
just for your benefit,
yeah.
F1 back in the day, it used to be when something, and it's this still happens today, when something is not in the rules, but it's not specifically banned in the rules, there's pretty much free play to it.
Yeah, yeah.
And what wasn't specifically like outlined in the rules was the amount of testing that each team was allowed to do during the season or before the season, with the cars coming up. So you obviously, I mean, at the beginning it was innocent. They just whatever. Like, you know, test your cars. Obviously test your cars. Yeah, test your cars. But what got out of hand in the 70s and even up until the early 2000s, when teams like Ferrari, the bigger teams, mm-hmm. that own racetracks, like Ferrari owns, used to own more racetracks. Now I think they only own a couple now. But anyway, they have their own racetracks, they could just run their cars there all day and perfect them. And some of the smaller teams that were just starting up obviously didn't own a fucking racetrack.
And then you want to rent one for a weekend, you might cost you $30,000-$40,000.
Yeah. You know, you know what I mean? So it was,
oh my God,
the cost for the smaller teams were just getting out of hand. So it as a way to level the field and to make things fair for everybody, guys, now F1 has limited in-season and pre-season testing for the cars. So and it's all very regulated by the FIA. And so there's two pre-season testings, and the pre-season testings have been happening recently and basically in
Isn't
Spain.
Isn't there three this year?
Two pre-season and then one in-season.
I think there's three and two.
Well, no, there's two in Barcelona.
Last year there was three preseason and four in-season tests.
Right. Yeah, there's two in Barcelona, one in Jerez. So the first preseason test, it's three. But I guess in my mind I was counting Barcelona, the two Barcelona tests as one. Yeah,
there's two separate weekends there. Yeah. We'll talk about this, I think, next week, all the rule changes. But next year is going to be severely restricted.
Oh, for sure.
If you can think this year was compared to last year.
So right now we are at the beginning of of the first preseason test, and it happens, actually both preseason tests happen in Spain, in the south of Spain. This one is in the province of Cadiz. The town is called Jerez de la Frontera, so it's the Jerez test.
Even though you're just about as far as south as you can get in Europe over there.
There's an argument to that, because I guess the boot of Italy is goes further south, but Italy, I guess, would be more expensive to rent racetracks there.
I'm just saying, like, even though there was dudes wearing winter coats yesterday and still got, you know, some semi-winter weather there. I'm sure it's not snowing, obviously.
Mm-hmm. But no. It's not snowing in Spain right now. So they do the testing in Spain in this track that used to be an F1 venue.
Yeah, they used to race there.
That's why they picked that there, because it still is, I guess, technically qualified by the FIA. It's still a good, like a modern enough track, or a modernized enough. It has the right type of tarmac, so it creates the conditions that cars can get significant data, and they're allowed to run. So this testing lasts for 4 days.
Right.
And right now we're in the third day. It's today. But let's talk about testing. Let's talk testing, because this preseason testing has generated more buzz than I think all the other preseason testings since I've been watching F1 regularly, because of the changes that have happened to the sport and to the teams and everything that's going on, all the drama, all the driver movements, everything's been crazy.
I'm getting goosebumps. Honestly, I'm surprised. Last year I didn't even really watch the testing. I checked the highlights.
Yeah.
But it was like, man, I was like, these new engines are going to suck.
Right.
Half of them aren't even running. These cars are breaking down the first race. Everybody's going to run out of gas. But that's being disproven. Cars are awesome. I think we're going to see some.
I have a very good indication also, like, why this test is important and why it's generated a lot of buzz. Guess the number of days since the last race last year in Abu Dhabi and the first day of testing. Days in between the last race last year in Abu Dhabi and this day.
It's short, man. Maybe less than 60.
69. Wow. Oh, yeah. So we're off to a good start, I'd say.
Barely 2 months, man. That's
actually,
short.
Yeah. This is short. One of the shortest off seasons we've had.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, it's happening at Jerez. Lots of cars got launched there. So that's what we're gonna talk, and we picked this picture right here that we're seeing, Mike, because it's the car that didn't make it.
It's not, yeah. We picked this picture because it didn't make it. It's not as far as you can tell, it's not a render. These dudes are sitting on it.
No, this car actually like made it to Mexico. This one, right?
What's with this thing here? What's going on with this? It looks like a heat sink for a computer.
Oh, dude, that's the front wing. That we're going to talk about all year. Trust me. Yeah.
Something they did last year with this new engine formula is they wanted to bring, they're hoping to bring more. They did bring more skill into the driver's hands instead of the car.
Right.
So that front wing used to be the same width as the outside of the tires. Now they brought it I don't know how many, but a few centimeters inside.
It's closer.
So you can see those sort of fins on the front wing there are curving outside. They're trying to basically force the air outside the tires.
Ah, okay.
Outside the car.
Before, I mean, if you actually, a lot of drag. If you go back to that picture with the sparks, yeah, right there. You see, front wings in F1 cars used to be very simple things.
Yeah.
Like just like two or three elements. If you go back to a modern front wing.
If you look at a car from about 4 or 5 years ago.
Yeah, even then.
It's surprisingly simple. It looks like a piece of like sheet metal, one piece. Now they had one car testing on the first day had an 8-element front wing.
That's eight little winglets and whatever.
Eight levels of wing.
Eight levels of
wing. Now is that for the down drag? Like,
oh yeah,
to force it down.
So more and more.
Vortexes and
not only for the front wings. Yeah, more and more. F1 engineers have found that the front wing is crucial to have bang on because it directs the airflow around the entire car. So the air that comes here is gonna bounce off the wheels and then go down there or go down in the car or go through here. Anyway, it shapes how the airflow is gonna go all the way down to back here on the diffuser. Mm-hmm. So getting this right is crucial. And if you fuck up your front wing during a race, mm-hmm. you're pretty much done. Like you need to get another one or
like Kvyat.
A weird question, but like are there like if say like an F1 car gets sort of damaged, but not like totally out of do they bring replacement parts?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Like front wings and
we'll talk about Kvyat in a second, but because
that happened yesterday.
During races?
Yeah.
You will see that like
will they come back from something like that? Like
If you depending on where you get the wheel broken and what at what point in the race it is. So if your wing comes out and it's say in the middle of a race, then you most likely have to go to the pits anyway to change tires.
Yeah.
So it can be like a double pits. You come in, you change your tires and you change your front wing, everything is good, you go back and you lose minimal time.
Are they compartmentalized in some sort of way where like almost like
not
like a Lego thing but like
yes you can no no yeah, yes yeah. yes exactly what you're thinking
that okay whole and nose from the wheels forward, the whole nose and the wing is all one big piece.
Yeah, that's all one big piece that they can like take out and put in like in seconds.
So they essentially have like a replacement car.
Oh yeah.
You'll see six dudes come out and change that wing. Two guys will undo one bolt on each side. Two guys will pull it off and two guys will put the new one on and two guys will tighten the
bolt. It gets done in like 2-3 seconds, man. It's ridiculous. But yeah.
Just a quick fact. One of those wings, even a simpler one, can take about 1,000 man hours to build without a carbon fiber.
Oh my God!
They're basically handmade.
Now they're handmade. I'm looking at this thing here, and this back wing here is the one that like doesn't seem like it fits.
They narrowed.
I don't know why. Maybe I'm just used to the ideal Formula One car
with a wider
with
one,
a more wide.
Yeah, lower. They brought that was by regulation because to decrease the downforce that it produced so that it would be more of a driver's skill. Rather than you want to see drivers wrestle the car into submission.
Right, right. We've talked about this before.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But this is the big talk going into next year and the year after. The next year they want to bring back that aggressive look in 2017. The engine.
But that it does look real aggressive. That big ass back wing, that looks mean. I do like that look.
Yeah, those
I've gotten
low
used
wings.
To this.
But couldn't you like say? Like, obviously, this angle here has something to do with the downforce that it produces.
Yeah. Yes,
now,
correct.
Could you not, say, have a wider wing, but a different angle?
Correct. Yeah,
you'll see that race to race.
Yeah.
The tracks that are more straight ahead, like Canada and Monza, you'll see them to come with a narrow wing that's like 2 inches.
Right.
And then you go to like Monaco or something where it's pure downforce, the wing is fat, like 6 inches.
Oh, wow.
You can change.
And so it all depends on the race.
On the race itself, on the circuit, but yeah, what you're saying, saying intrinsically can be done. So yeah, if they went back to the days when they had that really, really wide back wing, then the FIA can step in and just say, okay, now we're only going to give you like a limit of how big the wing can be, period. Okay. So then they'll have to play around within those constraints.
Gotcha.
But yeah, they can be done. Formula One cars can still look meaner and badder.
Yeah. I mean, it looks aggressive. Mm-hmm. I mean, this front thing over here, if I just bring it up, it looks like it's got teeth.
Yeah, that's just about to chew you.
Yeah, it's about to eat you.
So, but anyway, we'll move on in a second because these guys, didn't actually show up.
Yeah.
And I think
they're just like, nah, forget it.
Jay, I think, isn't even convinced that you're going to see this car at the track ever. This was what they just brought to Mexico.
I think they brought this because they released released this car in Mexico. Obviously, because this guy here, Sergio Perez, Checo, he is Mexican. Checo. So a lot of their sponsorship money of this team of Force India comes from Mexican money. Even this, like this sticker, Claro, that's a Mexican a cell phone company, mm-hmm. Telcel as well. You know, they get a lot of Mexican money just for having that Mexican driver, and they want to get more Mexican money because the rumor is that Force India isn't paying their bills. They're saying that they're in financial trouble, as is much of Vijay Mallya's empire in India.
Yeah, so this dude Vijay Mallya was he the richest man? He was one of the richest men in India.
He was one of India's billionaires.
You ever heard of the Kingfisher Enterprise? He had an airline. What do you have? He had an alcohol company.
Yeah.
Kingfisher Airline was his big business. And after 2008, he got smoked. This is the VJ M08. He names a car after himself. So they've been here 8 years. They're into it.
Yeah. No, he is a racer at heart. I think he actually does have a passion for F1. And it's too bad that he's getting poorer now, because when he was richer, he was he was able to invest more of his own personal money into F1. But now he's struggling. And because he's struggling financially, his team is struggling financially. And actually, the word from Force India now is that they didn't take part on, they're not going to take part on this first preseason test in Jerez at all.
Well, they were only expected to even show up with last year's engine and drivetrain.
Oh yeah,
but they're not even ready.
But now what they're saying is that because of efficiency concerns or efficiency issues, they didn't show up. But actually, what probably happened is that they were trying to find some aspiring F1 driver or aspiring driver, or actually anybody with money and anybody rich that was into car racing to actually buy the seat. They were basically going to go. They were going to be like, here, we have 4 days of testing. For the right amount of money, you can come and drive our car around. Oh. And you know, so that's how low they sank. But obviously, this is not what they would say to the public.
Right.
To the public, it's an efficiency concern, a money efficiency, I would say.
Yeah.
You can see that their nose is inefficient. Any team that you see now this year with the nose shorter than the front end of the wing has spent some time engineering and money on it.
Okay.
Because there's a requirement for a much more deceleration in a front end crash this year. Okay. So that front end wing has to compress lower and absorb a lot more energy. So what a lot of teams did is they just stuck it out further, but it's less efficient. You get less air forces underneath the car that way.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the FIA, and this is what I was trying to tell you, how I was trying to explain to you before, how F1 is special because the FIA, the regulatory body, comes up with these rules and says, here's a formula. Here's the rules for the car. This is what you got to do. Now build the car to meet these expectations. And one thing that they have to meet is there's a cross section at a certain level that they have to satisfy. So the wing has to be like this at some point, but that doesn't mean that they can't build further out. Mm-hmm. But it just has to be there. It's got to be a cross section there. And the interpretation of the rules, you'll see, varies from team to team. And actually, a couple of teams here and there arrived at the same solution. But there are differences, and you'll see in the next couple of pictures that we're gonna bring up. Mm-hmm. And actually, by the way, thanks to GP Update for this picture.
Lastly, I just want to talk about this livery because I don't know. I hate it. It's basically they mirrored the black and silver of McLaren's livery with the orange around it.
Or McLaren,
mirrored them. I don't know. Yeah. But the thing is, though, that McLaren yesterday said that this is not their livery. It'll be changing. They won't say what color. They won't say when.
We'll talk about McLaren when we get the McLaren out.
But basically, we'll get to McLaren. But basically, I just want to talk about the livery here. It looks like they fucking copied McLaren with a mirror. The black and silver is reversed. And these guys, up until last year, was white, green, and orange. That's
crazy.
Because like the India flag.
Because that's the colors of India. Yeah.
Okay.
They should have stuck with it, man. That
car looked badass.
When I think of India, that's what I think of is everything is fucking colorful. It's oversaturated.
Yeah,
with the rainbows coming out of it.
And you know how and this is something I read a user pointed this out. You know how Ted Kravitz
we can move on. I think
used to get kind of sometimes get.
I'm gonna throw it on to the next one.
Yeah, go for it.
Let's go to Lotus.
Yeah, you know how Kravitz used to get confused sometimes during his commentary between the two Force Indias.
Right.
Or the two Mercedes. Now, if Mercedes and Force India have basically the same livery, he's going to be like, now Alonso just overtook Sergio Perez, or it could have been Hülkenberg, or it could have been Button, or it could have been Alonso himself. Alonso overtaking Alonso.
Or last year's drivers. If you look at some of the results from this week, they got last year's drivers, like they got Vettel and Red Bull still.
Yeah.
I saw BBC had the first day Alonso's name in Ferrari's time.
So
let's talk about the second worst team this week.
Well, wow. Lotus didn't even make it the first day.
That's what I'm talking about. They missed day one.
Yeah. So they clocked no time in day one, which is, I mean, there's a long season ahead. I mean, this year is going to go from mid-March till the end of November, the very end, the last weekend of November.
Yeah,
these guys, and with all the changes and everything that's going to happen during the year, they need to get going in testing. Whoever is not showing up to testing, even for a day, you're losing significant amount of data. Yeah. But I would like to add to that maybe they didn't really miss much, because the first day's testing for Lotus was allocated to Pastor Maldonado, so maybe he was going to crash anyway.
Actually, I don't think they didn't even run on day two, did they?
No, they did. They did clock sometime on day two, I believe so. On the Monday, that was also Maldonado. He didn't do much.
Oh, yeah, I see.
He caused a red flag, obviously.
You got 125.8 seconds lowest behind Jensen Button, who...
But we'll talk about like the timing when it comes to that. But look at the nose of this. So that's this is what I was saying. There's another interpretation to the nose, and they decided to go as far back as they could.
The attachment of those two pylons looks like it's barely holding onto it. Like, it's held on by the corner of the front of the pylons.
Yeah,
and the depth of the centerpiece of that wing, mm-hmm. the horizontal beam there is. Narrow, man. It's small.
It's really good. So do you remember the other nose? Look at this nose. Yep. This nose is basically as far. They took it as far back as they could, and somehow.
And the smallest crash section. Yeah, possible.
Somehow this made it through the crash test. I don't know how, but
they did it.
Yeah.
What's entailed with the crash test?
Okay. Well, the FIA also, like, obviously, because they got to look after the safety. They, before these cars like become official and whatever, they have to take the parts and crash them, and actually do, you know, how modern cars are put through crash tests. They do the same with Formula One cars, basically to a degree. With sometimes it's just with individual parts.
Yeah.
So they'll crash test the nose crash it. And this it has to survive.
This is where you get the trouble with the 1,000 hours going into each wing. When they have to crash test each one.
Yeah.
You have to make multiple the same.
Exactly. Yeah, and so this wing there's a requirement, Mike, where it basically has to crash in such a way that some of it gets destroyed, but not destroyed enough that it's gonna affect this driver.
Right.
See, his feet. Can you imagine where his feet are?
His feet are. It must be somewhere over here, right?
Yeah, they're like up here or something. But it also can't be rigid. So there's then going to become a projectile that's going to injure another driver if he crashes into somebody else.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. So that's the problem with the crash testing, and wings that are that far back. Obviously, like you're like running into some dangerous territory here.
Yeah.
Because a lot of teams, what they decided to do is go like actually the other way and go and make it really long to satisfy that. Anyway,
I think the teams that went longer spent less money. I believe that's less ideal. Mm. Plus, everyone complained about that last year. And before we move on here, one more thing about these guys' engine. They're not running Renault anymore.
Oh, right. Yeah. This team used to be like have a very long-standing association with Renault. But Renault, they're a European car maker from France. Mm. They had pretty much the worst engines last year.
Yeah.
So they They went and ditched them as soon as they could, and they got Mercedes engines now, which are supposed to be running quite well. They're just having some trouble maybe putting all the power of the new Mercedes engines down on the road. So these cars, like, so Maldonado, but he's not that great a driver anyway, but he was skidding all around the road. I mean, better than me, but.
I just sent you, I sent you one more link here if you want to.
All right.
You can pull that up. I just want to give you, or anybody that maybe didn't follow last year, just the idea of how these rules have changed a bit. You look at the Lotus of last year. Yeah, throw it anyway.
Yeah, you look at that nose.
This was the most extreme.
Hold on. It's not, they are not
interpretation of last year.
Yeah, here we go.
Yeah, this is the most extreme interpretation of last year's front end.
Oh my God.
Most teams had a single tusk. These guys basically look like a walrus.
Yeah. But the one...
Why is one...
Because this one here was made so that it would satisfy the regulations.
Last year, they had a minimum length.
Yeah. So, yeah. So,
and a minimum cross-section.
Yeah. So this one here was the tusk, as it were, that would satisfy the regulations. So this was the actual front end. This thing here was made just so that it would become another beam of support for the wing.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. Just support the cross-section rule.
What they were trying to do here is basically leave this space open in the middle so that more air would go under the car.
This thing looks... Fucked.
Yeah, it looked ugly, and it didn't do anything.
I disagree, man. I hate all this shit. Well, last year, but everyone's saying these cars are ugly.
I don't know. It's not ugly. Come on, man. Car.
They made the rules. That's what they came up with.
Yeah. So
who
I mean,
gives a fuck what it looks like.
Okay. Well, so the FIA like just and you know, God bless them, but they were short-sighted enough to leave room for some monstrosity like this. But
whatever.
But yeah. Anyway, get that off the screen.
I'm so glad this ugly discussion is over. Yeah. I'm sick of it.
Yeah. Get that off the screen.
Whatever. Okay. We can talk about ugliness a little bit.
Because it's pretty ugly.
This car looks like it came from the fucking knockoff section at the knockoff dollar store. This is like... This car... If this was at the dollar store and you picked up the package, you would just say like Formula Racing or something, and it would be spelled wrong.
Formula, like,
yeah.
It's like instead of Sonic, it's just like Sanic.
Yeah.
This car looks like a piece of shit. What's surprising?
Poor guys, though. I mean, Sauber is a team that had a lot of promise, and actually is one of the few teams left in Formula One that is there just for the racing. Mm. They are there to compete in Formula One, and that is all they do. For Red Bull is there to sell soft
Red
drinks.
Bull.
Ferrari is there to sell sports cars.
Right.
So is Mercedes. These guys are a thoroughbred racing team, and they're not even... A lot of people also applaud them for being different and not being based out of Motorsport Valley in England. They are based out of Switzerland, and they're a Swiss racing team, and they're Swiss through and through or whatever, and they're racers, and we would love for them to do better. And they actually in 2013 they had a pretty good showing, but 2013 was the last of you know, the years with the previous regulations. They switched the engines and they switched everything in 2014, and they didn't score a single point last year.
Oh, no.
Not a single point. Yeah, they did really bad. And the thing is that they're Ferrari powered, and the Ferrari engines weren't doing that great last year either. Yeah.
They still are powered completely Ferrari drivetrain, except they have designed their own suspension.
Mm.
The rear suspension in these cars typically mounts to as low as possible, not usually to the chassis, but to the engine or transmission.
The analysts,
so they come as a package, or they're sold.
The analysts that have checked this car out, they've basically come to the conclusion that it's basically the 2014 car.
It's almost exactly the same.
Yeah, with just the minimum changes that they had to do to satisfy the 2015 regulations.
Right. Okay.
So it's but listen, hasn't it been clocking some good times during testing?
That's what I was going to say. It looks like a piece of shit.
Go ahead.
Okay, I was. We'll come
back. Well, it has been surprisingly reliable, but that has been the deal with Ferrari engines. It seems like Ferrari took to heart whatever happened, and they actually came up with a better car for themselves, and also and actually also a better engine. But anyway, yes. What do you have anything else to say about the Sauber? Oh, yeah. The colors.
Yeah, the livery is maybe my favorite because, well, okay, it's colorful. I like that.
Yeah.
Well, many of these cars are just fucking black and silver, like,
or just have ads all over them.
Well, oh, these guys don't have ads, but it's not by choice. It's because they couldn't get any sponsors because they did so poorly last time.
Oh no!
This guy, the guy who you see driving there, Felipe Nasr, he's a
Brazilian,
second Brazilian driver now. He brought the reason he's driving is because he brought Banco do Brasil sponsorship to the team. That's the blue and yellow you're seeing.
The blue and yellow. And also, I guess, like, Ericsson, he's Swedish, so the blue and yellow also works for him.
Yeah,
but,
sure.
Yeah.
That's a coincidence.
I mean...
Is it, though?
In my heart of hearts, I really, really, really like it when Sauber does well. Because Sauber should be a team... I mean... Because they're a constructor, an F1 constructor, and that's all they do. Mm-hmm. And because they're not based in Britain, that if they do well, if they're profitable, and if they're getting F1 constructor points, that means that it can be done. Mm-hmm. That means that it can that the new entrants to the sport have somebody to look up to and say, hey, listen, if Sauber did it, we can do it too.
Right. Totally.
So that's if Sauber does well, it's good for Formula One. It's good for the fans. It's good for the sport in general.
Mm-hmm. It's really tough because it's hard to tell what's going on with the times and efficiencies of these cars because there's sandbagging, et cetera, et cetera. But the thing is, on the second day, Felipe Nasr here driving this car came second. He's 0.8 seconds behind Ferrari with Vettel.
So that could mean
one lap short of Ferrari as well.
So that could mean that either they're doing really well or that these times are completely meaningless.
Mm. Yeah, the other teams are sandbagging.
Yeah.
But then today he went fastest and he beat Red Bull by about 15 laps. Or sorry, Ferrari.
Yeah.
Their parent team. They did about 15 more laps of testing than them.
Holy moly.
Yeah. Which maybe because they had to, I'm not sure.
Yeah, good on them. I want to see Sauber score some points this year. That is, they've said it, that's
underdog?
Underdog.
Yeah, big time.
Yeah, big time.
They're my favorite now.
Yeah. We missed this so far. This car is called the C34. Lotus is the E23.
For Enstone, because that's where they make the car.
Right. And the Force India, the VJ-M08. Named after Vijay Mallya, the guy who runs the team.
The next picture just shows all of them, and I really like this picture. Zoom in even more. Even more.
We'll talk about these guys next.
Okay, so we have
this
right
where you
now
start
Williams.
Even more diversity in the front nose. There.
Yeah, look at that.
Look at this fucking thing.
Yeah,
this looks crazy.
Yeah. Oh, with a martini livery. The Coke bottle shape. Of course, yeah. Williams is a team that did really well last year. They have the Mercedes engine, and out of the Mercedes engine teams, they did pretty much the best.
Aside from Mercedes themselves.
Aside from Mercedes themselves, yeah. They were the ones that were able to like mount the challenge.
Here's something you can see on the far side is some Flovis paint.
This blue stuff here.
And you can tell... By those tires that are just marked with spray paint, those are the test tires. We'll talk about this at the end, but Pirelli's designed an entirely new Super Soft for this year, which is what they're testing there. They're not printed.
So Super Soft tires, essentially, they would bring him to a race that would be a dry race and a race a racetrack that would be a faster racetrack.
Okay.
They are fast tires, but as the name implies, the compound that they use is super soft.
Yeah. Typically,
and
the courses
they get destroyed easier than the soft tires, for example.
Typically, the courses with like heavier cornering give you more grip. We need more grip. Typically, more downforce as well.
But no, go back.
This is the FW37. Is the name of their car?
It's Williams is another team that only exists for motor racing.
Okay.
They don't make cars. They don't sell like Williams wristbands anywhere. No, they just They're there to race, and they were very successful. Remember that car with the sparks that we talked with, yeah. With the crazy suspension? That was a Williams. This is a Williams. Okay. Now, Williams had a period of harshness recently,
yeah.
Where they were basically at the same level as Sauber. They weren't doing much, and everybody kind of missed, like, everybody had that feeling of like, oh, if Williams is struggling, like, nobody wants to see Williams struggle because they're to race. And now they're back. They have the right engine. They seem to have the right engineering spirit. They have the right driver with Valtteri Bottas, which is going to be a star of the future. This kid that's driving the car, he's going to be a champion. Like, give it a couple of years, I'd say.
Definitely.
Yeah. And so, lots of excitement about the Williams. Hopefully they keep riding that momentum that they had last year. Hopefully they can genuinely mount the challenge to Mercedes. And if you see right here in the side pod,
I think those side pods are pretty wide. If you compare it to some of the other ones, they're wide, man. Those are
what is this? What's going on here?
Well,
these are two intakes.
Yeah, intakes for the radiators.
The radiator on each side.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you see above the driver, this car above the driver's head, he's got two intakes there. He's got one, and then there's a smaller one just under.
Yeah.
Okay, right here.
So I believe that bottom one is probably for the turbo intercooler.
Oil cooler and water cooler usually.
Yeah, it depends. I forget now. I think Mercedes added a turbo intercooler this year. I'm not 100%. Not 100%.
This thing looks cool. I like it.
Yeah, and so the engine sits right here.
Okay.
Somewhere around there. So these are for the radiator. So, yes, actually, as you can see, yeah, if they're bigger here, that means that the air has a lot more struggle going around. So, yeah, you want to keep this area of the car packaged as tightly as possible.
You'll see the difference when we scroll down in a second. But then typically, like, that air going into those side pods is coming out the bottom just kind of in front of those back tires.
So, yeah. So, here's what we're talking about before. So, you can see now how the air is here. Hopefully, clean air.
Yeah.
Comes here, hits the first thing that it hits is obviously the front wing. And the front wing is going to channel it either around or up or down or a combination of that.
Right.
Through the suspension, that now the suspension, even look at this suspension. Yeah. Each one of these elements is a wing in and of itself.
Right? Okay.
Yeah, it's not just a tube. And it's a wing, so it can channel the air even further down all the way here, all the way to the back, generating downforce.
Quick Williams fact. I believe the front suspension arm, they're the only team that sells advertising on there.
Oh, really? Is there an ad on that? Oh,
yeah.
My bad.
I think they're long. It's Hatch, I think. Or used to be Hatch last year.
This dude, Frank Williams, basically started from nothing with no factory backing or anything. He knows how to raise money, and that's how he became big.
Well, it was him and his buddy, Patrick Head. Him and this engineer that started this. Now, this is interesting here, right? The Rexona. I think it's a deodorant brand. Anyway, it's owned by Unilever, one of the biggest companies in the world when it comes to like household stuff, like deodorants and fucking shampoo and shit.
Right.
Like they own the Dove brand and whatever.
Oh, okay.
So Unilever used to be affiliated with Lotus. So clearly these guys did so well last year that they snatched that sponsorship right off of them.
Yeah. God damn.
The Lotus livery, not a super lot, but it's changed this year.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. That's all I get about them. Their livery is the same as last year. They, I don't know, cheaped out on their nose a little bit. They got a little nub there, a little crash structure.
Yeah, but
that might change. It's mostly a lot of small changes. They did really well last year. And
yeah, they're basically working on an improvement of last year's car. There was, because their last year's car was a good, competent car, all they have to do is start from something that's good and make it better.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Scroll down. The Red Bull.
Fucking thing. I saw someone sent me a picture of this. Not you guys.
Really?
Weirdly enough, yeah.
Before let's start at the back here. Okay, we were just talking about the Coke bottle shape.
Yeah.
So if you look at that Renault, how tight it is just in front of that back wing. Now scroll up.
Yeah.
Scroll up.
Oh, look at that. Look at the difference.
Yeah.
I don't know, man.
And
there's... Yeah.
Sorry, man.
I think the Renault made some little improvements. Last year they were, I think Red Bull was the tightest. It's like their car was wearing a girdle almost on the back.
Yeah. But Red Bull actually, they have Adrian Newey is still, even though he doesn't have that much involvement in the team, he's still the chief designer of the Red Bull cars. And Adrian Newey actually is, as far as designers of cars, of F1 cars, he's basically known as the best. He's the best by quite a measure.
Yeah.
Now he's the best, and because he's won with F1 with different F1 teams, and he's been in the sport for quite a while, he wants to kind of retire from F1. Yeah,
it's and probably his last year.
I think you on and off, like he's even this year, he's already only focusing only 50% of his time on the development of the F1 program. The rest, that. Yeah, he's working. He has all the other projects on the side, so he's been working on the boat to take on the America's Cup.
Oh wow!
You know, yeah, those catamarans.
The big sailboat.
Yeah, yeah. And there might be a Red Bull road car.
Oh wow!
Yeah, so
that would be pretty incredible.
Yeah.
Well, do you remember that thing at Montreal? Mm. I should bring that picture maybe next time. But we saw in the parking lot somebody's car that showed up at the track.
It was like a weird Red Bull tricycle.
Maybe this table here was about the size of this three-wheeled car. Mm-hmm. It looked like a fucking go-kart, but it was clearly street legal.
Yeah.
Oh, like, crazy.
Another thing that
kind of like the Ariel Adam, if you've ever seen that.
Mike, I think that they've been experimenting for a while, and that might blow your socks off. Is if you see the S duct, but
blown.
See this wheel nut, and like, compared to the one on the back.
Two teams have done this.
Yeah, so that looks like a point, right?
Yeah.
This looks like it's hollow because it is. So what this is doing, what they're trying to do with this is bring the air from the front wing again, channel it through this duct here.
That's the brake duct.
Yeah, so the brake duct and the brakes of an F1 car under braking can reach 1,000 degrees or more. These things are carbon brakes. Fuck. They're ridiculous. We were talking about ridiculous numbers here. So super, super hot air. Mm-hmm. And then instead of exiting like...
out through whatever, or anything,
it's going to get channeled through this hole. Out that way. And eventually, they want, like, so the idea is, like, the air comes out of here, yeah. And it's going to come out in such a way that it's going to be filtered through,
basically vacuumed back in underneath the car.
And then down that way to generate extra downforce.
But
it's basically, like,
wouldn't you not want all that hot air, though? Like,
hot air goes faster than cold air.
Oh,
and
that's
the faster that it goes, it creates a pressure differential. It pushes the car down.
And they need to be removing almost as much heat as possible from those brakes.
Yeah.
And okay. So what we're talking about with the front wing there. Basically, see the back tip sort of like is hooked out. So that's forcing that as much front air as possible around the front tire and creating almost a wall there that's going to force that heated air back. And because a lot of that air from in front of the wheel is getting forced out through the nut.
Yeah.
You get like a negative pressure behind the wheel that forces that air back in and gets sucked into the diffuser and underneath that Coke bottle girdle at the back.
Yeah.
And up over the monkey seat and through the diffuser, basically.
Now they did this livery that is basically the zebra pattern, camouflage. It's a type of camouflage that was first developed. I think it was during World War II. The Royal Navy used to paint their ships like this.
Giant ships.
So they would like get confused in the water. It has the effect that visually, and especially since these cars are going to be moving, you don't get to detect very much about the curve, the mm-hmm. curves and whatever. But even just us idiots talking about this have been able to point out a few things. So I think that this, God bless him, but it's had the opposite effect that they wanted. They wanted people to look at their cars and not see what was going on. But because everyone knew that that's clearly a camouflage, everybody is now looking at it.
Effect.
Yeah, yeah. So everybody's looking at it and try to figure out what are they hiding? What do they want to hide with this? Yeah.
Honestly, I love this thing. If you, I'm going to try to find it in a second here. Well, just when somebody else is talking. But some dude on Reddit photoshopped this car and basically put the regular Red Bull colors, the red, yellow, and purple.
Oh, crazy.
On this?
Onto that pattern and faded.
It looks sick.
It looks badass.
Really?
Yeah.
But I don't know. They're saying they're not running with this year.
No.
Oh, they're not going? They're not going
No,
with this
is this? Just for testing. Just for...
Oh, okay.
I've also seen this, I think, maybe like 2 weeks ago. I think it was watching Jay Leno's Garage on YouTube. He was he got the opportunity to test some new production car that wasn't on the street yet, but they're at a track day. And they basically do this type of paint job over the track car as well to keep spies from putting it in car magazines or whatever.
Sure.
Another thing with this car, which it's very reminiscent of the F-duct that were around a couple of years ago.
Actually, you know what? If you one of these pictures...
We got a head-on picture. There we go.
Boom.
So you see where that word the number three is basically the driver number.
Yeah.
You notice how that's raised a little bit.
Right? Yeah. It's like it lifts. Sort of see that. So air comes in through this arrow here.
Yeah.
That's a duct, and it does its thing there. I don't know what it actually. Danny, you're more into
They're calling this an S duct, but
it gives them some sort of aero advantage. Is it, in the end what they're looking for with that?
Yeah, basically, I think is probably they have enough air moving under the car that once it's moved over that bottom, that wing, the low air comes over the front wing, and instead of all of it going under the car, some of it goes through that hole and gets dumped there into the driver's face and then goes up. So into the engine,
to the intercooler.
Oh, into the intercooler, mm-hmm. into
oh,
the
shit.
Over the back wing and into the engine, to the intake itself. So I guess obviously the air closer to the ground is going to be cooler.
Hmm.
So they're getting some of that too, some of that effect. Like when you're driving behind another car that's throwing out flames more or less, the air closest to the ground is going to be the coolest. You want that going into your engine, but the air that gets sucked into the intake is above the driver's head, which is hot, right?
Totally.
So I don't know. That's
we can go back to.
We'll see. I guess as the season moves. But we talked about this a couple of weeks ago. They had similar types of intakes and outlets a couple of years ago, but they were like mechanical. On the straightaways, they were kind of doing the opposite, though, as I think they were sucking air from the top of the car and pushing it under the car to get less downforce.
Right.
Whereas this is the opposite, to get, I think, more downforce and cleaner air.
Now, Mike, again, just to point out one more thing about the Red Bull.
Yeah, what else do you got? The RB11.
Right. Yeah, the RB11, by calling everybody the same. Last year and this year, obviously, like all the Red Bulls are known for being very tightly packaged.
Yeah.
Right? Like you just saw the difference between the two.
I think they got bumped to second place this year.
Yeah. But even then, because it's so tightly packaged, at the beginning of the year, they were having problems that some parts were melting inside because there was no room to breathe.
Right. Yeah,
so
yeah.
So who knows how this year that's going to fare. And you never saw that during testing. You only saw that kind of stuff like in a race situation.
When it actually happened. Yeah. Right. Okay.
I don't think they're going to have any problems. You never know. But last year, first testing week, they barely had the Renault engine running, and there were questions whether or not they even make it to Australia.
A lot of people were also looking at this car, and they've identified a couple of things. They said, like, well, look at the nose. It's got elements from the Williams up here. And actually, the back of it, towards the back and the back suspension, it has elements from the Ferrari of last year. And it's kind of like a mix-and-match car. And people are taking that as another indication that maybe Newey is not having that much time to spend in the car. And also that maybe it's too much of a workload, because now Red Bull is essentially the works Renault team.
Right.
Renault is working very, and actually Renault, you know, going from giving their engines to the many F1 cars before, now they only give their engines to two cars, the Red Bull and the Toro Rosso. And the Toro Rosso is owned by Red Bull. So essentially only the Red Bull cars are running Renault engines. And there is a speculation that maybe they're spending too much time trying to figure out this Renault engine and bring it back. And they spent a lot of time trying to do that. And maybe this car is not going to be as competitive, or maybe we won't see it be as competitive until mid-year.
Wait, what did you say? Who else is running Renault this year?
Toro Rosso.
Aren't they Ferrari?
No. No. They weren't,
switched.
They weren't Ferrari even last year, dude.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
I don't know how I missed that.
Yeah.
It raced the last 30 seconds. Yeah, but this car, I think... I don't know, man. They're tighter for sure than the Mercedes engine. If you scroll up, it's noticeable. Especially go back where the A of the Rexona is and back. Now you look at back of the I of Infiniti on the same spot of the that car.
Yeah, that's crazy.
It's a big difference. And look at that, basically the floor of the car. See that piece?
This you can see so much.
How much is exposed? This? Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Whereas you can see even the undercut where that curves under to keep that floor as big as possible.
Yeah, no, that's huge.
The curve on the Red Bull is so much bigger.
Yeah. I think we can move on from Red Bull now to the McLaren Honda.
Should we start with how their car sounds? today. Let's
Did we do our thing?
Oh, hey, we haven't introduced our new contest.
I think we should maybe talk about this at the end. We'll leave it.
Okay. Okay. All right.
Anyways, all right. We are giving away more RFM invites. Yeah. We'll detail it at the end.
Yeah.
So these guys, on day one, they had some big trouble. They did, I think, 6 laps, and they were at, I don't know, at least 15 seconds slower than everybody else on the first day. Where they do the second day, I think even less.
Let's look actually at the car again. I mean, it's so we're talking about McLaren Honda, the return of the Honda engines to Formula One, and actually a spokesperson from Honda was quoted saying that leaving F1 when they did in 2009 was one of their biggest mistakes, and they plan to be
basically until the end of time.
Yeah, and yeah, they plan to be in F1 as a permanent fixture, and they chose McLaren to be their partner because they offer them the most, and they offer them the most time, and yes,
history.
And you can see that though. Apparently, their Awoking, which is the base of McLaren, there is a bunch of Honda engineers now stationed there permanently, and they are working very, very closely to McLaren, and a lot of people had you know the nostalgia factor of seeing the old McLaren Honda partnership that in the past was very successful. And seeing the old colors back, and now Fernando Alonso is driving for McLaren again, but this car looks like shit, honestly.
Do you think so?
Well, I mean,
man, you know what it looks like.
Can
I tell you what it looks like?
Yeah,
a Gillette razor blade.
Yeah.
Okay. It's got 5 blades for the deeper cut. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Funnily enough, who was it last year? Was the razor sponsor for McLaren?
Gillette.
Okay. Yeah. Because their driver who's held over from last year, Jenson Button, who's he's been in F1 for a long time.
Yeah.
He usually keeps like this, kind of like a stubble.
Yeah.
And I think he complained on camera last year one day, like they got a new sponsorship, Gillette, and he came out clean shaven. He's like, you know, he looked kind of pissed.
Like, I gotta fucking do this.
Yeah.
Like somebody has a mustache for years and then they cut it off.
You're like Mario. you look
weird, man.
Fernando Alonso driving that car though. Look at that. That's gonna be something that I'm not used to seeing right now.
Where's his red hat?
Yeah, Fernando Alonso.
We have to change his name to Alonso. Before we get too deep into this car though, just because we're talking about the look still, can we go back to that Force India, the first picture? No, not here.
Oh.
To the left, yeah, right where the finger is there. You see what I'm talking about? The liveries? The silver and black.
Ah.
Now we go back.
Where is it here?
Yeah, right there.
Oh, black and silver. Yeah.
It looks
with the orange stripe around.
It's got a blue tinge to it, but I think it's just because that's the sky.
It's probably just the reflection there.
Yeah.
Actually, you know what though? The interesting thing is that if you look at a Honda, like a Honda Civic, or like my Accord right now, that I just got fixed. Anyone wants to buy an Accord, email me. the paint is fresh on the bumper.
Okay.
So the other paint is whatever, like 5 years old. Just got repainted. Honda puts blue in all their black paint, so that could be that.
Oh, interesting. Like
the Honda Black has blue,
a little bit of blue
crystals in it. Any Honda you look at, if you look really close, there's a blue crystal.
Well, my RAV4 is blue, so I understand your pain.
That's a Toyota, though.
Yes.
Japanese anyway.
That's the same.
That's the same thing.
my car is actually black.
It's actually black.
It's black. Okay. Yeah, the Honda Black. Any Honda Black car, if you look close, it has blue in it.
Oh, that's crazy.
That's their thing. So it's interesting you said that. It might not be this guy.
But Ron Dennis already came out and said that this is going to be a testing livery. This is only going to be around for testing.
He did not say that.
Well, no. Well, not necessarily that it's a testing, but it could change any second or something.
He said that before the season started. There's hints about, are they going to go
back? No.
So the white and black?
White and red? Ron Dennis said that this livery is going to change, but he doesn't know when.
Here, I have his exact quote.
Yeah.
The 2015 livery will change. I won't say when.
Yeah.
And then I looked on his Twitter 37 minutes later.
Yeah.
McLaren themselves tweeted.
Oh, they tweeted that.
They tweeted exactly. This was a Ron Dennis tweet. 2015 livery will change. Won't say when. That was his exact quote. 37 minutes later, Ron says livery will change. And attached to that was a photograph of a really old picture, a car from the 70s that was orange.
The original, like Bruce McLaren.
Right. It seemed like they were taking votes.
Well, yeah. And so, no, what you would do, red and white versus orange. Right, exactly. So what you would do is you would either hit retweet for the orange livery or favorite for the red and white. I went in there and did what everybody should have done and favorited that post, because the black and the white and red is just so badass. It looks way better than that orange. I understand the historical...
That's it. Well, the white and red is history.
Yeah, the white and red is also history. But
Honda's other known color is the Honda Racing White. Any of the Type R's that have come out over the years Honda Racing White.
That actually harkens back to the days.
Blue in it.
Yeah, it goes back to the days when, like, very early F1, when Honda came from Japan, and it was basically the first non-European team to take part in the Formula One championship, and that was, like, you know, the founder of the company, Soichiro Honda, he was an avid racing fan, and obviously, like, he dressed his car like his national color, so Japan is red and white. And it looks sick. I think they should throw some red and white in there.
Even that white, man, it has a blue tinge. Honda Championship White is what it's called.
Oh yeah,
that's what it's called. Yeah. Anything you've ever seen, like the Civic Type R's, the special editions they put out, or the old Integra Type R's, or the RSX, they come in that white. It's called Championship White. If you ever see a white Type R Honda vehicle, that's what it is.
It's pretty cool too. I mean, that the British and the Japanese are getting back together at it. And one thing that I found interesting is Jensen Button was interviewed, and he was like, "Oh yeah, obviously I love Japanese culture and whatever, and I married a Japanese woman."
And obviously Alonso wants to be Japanese.
Well, Alonso wants to be Japanese. He wants to be a samurai. Oh, you know, Alonso already thinks he's a samurai. But anyway, so but one of the interesting things is that apparently when Japanese people say yes to you,
yes,
is that they mean that they understand you, not that they agree with what you just said, but I like, oh yeah, I understand, like
I understand, so, what you were saying,
yeah, so just nuances like that are things that the McLaren team are now having to iron out, but I'm sure that eventually they'll get it all straight out, and hopefully this partnership is gonna produce great things, because Alonso, for all that everybody says that, you know, maybe he doesn't have any more championships right now, and because of his own doing, he really does deserve it. He is really one of the greats in the sport, in the entire history of the sport. Alonso is one of the great drivers, and he deserves more than just two championships.
Somebody asked him, I think, on Sunday. So I think Sunday and Monday, McLaren did 6 laps each day, which is what all the other teams did in the first like 20 minutes. Each day, 6 laps each, and the car broke down. Mm-hmm. But somebody asked him, I think on the first day, are you ready to... He got to drive the car first because he's new to the team. Are you ready for being patient with this team to catch up? He's like, you know, my last 5 years, I think I've proved my patience. Because he hasn't won shit. Ferrari was doing terrible.
Yeah. So right. His last 5 years before this, he spent it. He moved to Ferrari with the promise that, oh, Ferrari and Alonso, we're gonna get some championships in. And a few years they got close, but nothing. Right, and actually Ferrari kept dropping the ball.
When he first signed the contract with Ferrari, it was almost unprecedented. I'm not sure if it was, but it was maybe one of the longest for sure contracts ever signed in the sport.
He became immediately the third best paid athlete in the world. Yeah, or something like that.
The third best paid athlete in the world, and he was originally contracted until the end of next year, 2 more years.
Yeah.
No, and then they dropped the contract?
No, well, not without a fight.
He worked his way out of it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well,
it hasn't really been made public.
The rumor is that his break clause, like the clause to break the contract early, said that he would have had to pay $80 million.
Yeah.
To break the contract, and apparently that money came from Honda. So Honda basically gave Alonso to give Ferrari $80 million.
I did not know that.
Not even like that. That wasn't even part of his salary. It's just, here's $80 million, just so you can get out of that contract and come race with us. So
he was getting paid 50 million euro per year, right? Dollars or euro?
I think his contract was like 30 million euro.
30?
Okay, 30 million euro, okay, though. Okay. Which would amount to
just almost $50 million.
That's fucking crazy.
Yeah.
Annually. 20 race weekends. I'm sure, obviously, he has a lot of media testing, et cetera,
totally.
Sport testing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
7 testing weekends wow. last year, actually.
Yeah. Well, Alonso was in a position where he could have basically named his price. Mm-hmm. Like, that's how desirable of a driver he is.
Wow.
Yeah.
So with these guys, I don't know. You said it's ugly or whatever. I don't see anything wrong with it. They have a lot of elements on that front wing. They got a bit of the platypus look from Ferrari last year.
Yeah, they have this sort of straight plank look to it, but it's not ugly.
Almost a Coke bottle shape to the nose itself.
Yeah, the nose doesn't go too far back like the Lotus did, so like clearly they're trying something else. The Coke bottle shape obviously is not wrapped tightly, but it's apparently the best effort that they could. They apparently wrapped it as tightly as they could, and you can kind of see that by the way that the light deflects here. This is kind of like it's a bump.
Bent in.
Yeah.
This is okay.
Or bent in or whatever.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah. So they tried to wrap it up as closely to the engine as it is. And that hump at the top.
Yeah.
A lot of people are saying that maybe Honda, what they have is a different kind of turbo that they're experimenting with. But
yeah, I think so. Well, what the interesting thing about their performance, especially the first 2 days, is that they've been bragging. What they're calling this design, their engine design, is size zero.
Size zero.
It's extremely tight. It is the tightest packaged engine that there is.
Yeah.
It's got the KERS device is tight up underneath.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how to say it, man. But anyway, the first 2 days, they had a lot of problems with it being too tight, that a lot of their sensors in the engine that communicate with each other through the ECU.
They basically weren't communicating.
Yeah, they weren't communicating. There's stuff shorting out and signals were crossing by induction and stuff like that.
Holy
like
shit.
The wires were too close and inducing on each other. They're getting a lot of backfiring and shit. The first 2 days, especially. The third day today, they managed, 32 laps. But let's play that video quickly now. Because the first 2 days, and this actually, maybe we'll talk about it now. This leads into round two.
Courtesy of user Vesic with double K on YouTube.
Just before we play this, the first 2 days, these guys did literally 6 laps, nothing on full speed. Like day one was 15 seconds slow, and day two was almost 33 seconds on the second day. Was their gap to first place to Vettel. But basically, their engine broke down the first 2 days, and they had to take it apart.
Oh my god!
But it was because of these little electronic gremlins that they kept having.
Oh, gremlins!
Yeah, maybe we can.
Those are the worst.
Should maybe talk about the contest here? It's kind of related to McLaren this week.
Well, okay, just let's play this clip.
Let's play this clip.
This is okay. So today, actually, on their third day of testing, they had a very successful day.
Okay.
And actually,
the engine sounded.
Let me talk about this for a second So what happens during this testing and one of the restrictions is that the teams are only allowed to run one car per day,
mm-hmm.
right? So they had to basically choose one driver to participate in each day.
Okay.
They couldn't like alternate drivers.
Oh, weird. Okay.
Yeah. So for McLaren, for example, the first day was given to Alonso. The second day was given to Button, and the third day today was given to Alonso again. And Alonso was out there actually, and so finally they figured something out, and Alonso was out on force, and actually you could see him in some corners that this track has, just like wrestling the car like up and down, which to me basically showed two things, that the Honda engine has a lot of power, mm-hmm. that is, because you saw him like skidding around, but it's because he just kind of lost control and then regained it and then lost control.
Maybe this could be very similar to Ferrari's problem last year. We'll talk about
exactly. I think
to correct it
altogether with maybe like they have a long way to go in terms of figuring out how to put all the raw power onto the road.
Right.
Yeah. So there's work to do. But yeah, let's listen to this because they did get the car figured out or the engine working for a big chunk.
This is day three. This is for anyone just listening to this. This is Alonso coming around the first corner. Listen. And corner two was the end of their day. Let's hear that one more time. You can hear they got about 30 laps of the car sounding good. And
hold up.
Kind of backfired.
That's good, 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 good. And your day's done.
Yeah, it sounds like a fart.
Let's hear it one more time. Let's give it a.
Let's be gratuitous with this. Something is not right.
So what do you think happened at that point?
I don't know, man. Not really sure, but probably is more sensor problems. It sounds like
a problem.
Yeah. That's a problem. And right after that, they called the car in, shut it down. We're done for the day.
It's probably a detonation problem, which is why I think they had the first 2 days. Like the piston is coming up and compressing the gas, and it's basically detonating before the spark does.
But they're also saying that it has something to do with the hybrid part of the car too.
The green bits.
Yeah, the green bits. The green bits attached to it. Yeah. So, but anyway, I mean,
sounding very rough.
Do we have anything else to say about the McLaren?
Let's go back to the picture quickly. I don't know, these guys. That front wing, we should have got pictures of the fronts of these cars, but whatever. They got really deep and tall with those front wing elements. Compared to the other cars, they got three fat wing elements pushing air around. And
I see these things here.
Those are crash structures, but they also
turning vanes as well.
Yeah, they also have managed now to turn it into to get some aero advantage out of it.
It's almost like a rudder when they turn. It keeps that air. Like that wall, like the wall of air that we were talking about.
Yeah.
It's going along the side of the car. Yeah. See, and these guys, like Red Bull, you notice those front wheel nuts?
Yeah.
Got holes in them.
Got holes in them too. A lot of teams are experimenting with that technology.
You had a second picture, Jay, of that, the nose of this McLaren, the bump on it. What is that?
Oh, no. Okay. So that's all the way at the back when we go into the timing of the third day. Yeah.
Is this for now?
So we can talk about it. So there's Alonso again.
Yeah, what the hell is that?
And they started running this. What this bump here is actually, you see this hole here? Like that right there?
Yeah.
There's a camera pointing to the wing, and what it's measuring, it's filming the whole session, and it's measuring how much the wing goes up and down, the flex of the wing throughout a lap.
Fuck that.
Just because they wanna make sure that it's as stiff as possible.
Well, that's fucking crazy.
That was because, was it last year that Red Bull got caught with the bendy nose?
Yes.
See, this was interesting. Last year, Red Bull with the infinite wisdom of the aero dude, the aero guru. Basically, okay, see, like, you could use this card as an example. Basically, from where that H is, the Honda symbol, basically the first 6 inches of the Red Bull last year.
Yeah.
They did...
They
had what we were talking about, a nose problem. During the lap, they had to change the front wing and nose. And as the guy was pulling the nose off, he kind of bumped it with its leg, and it bent like a piece of rubber.
Uh-oh.
So what they were doing was they made that outer rubber... Well, I guess the press structure inside, but it was some sort of material.
Flexible something.
At speed, it was forcing that nose down.
Oh, no.
Whatever.
Way.
One or two. Whatever. However much it was. It was a small amount, but it flexed down enough to force downforce and the aero advantage.
Get out.
Obviously, that's not allowed.
They changed that rule.
Super illegal.
They changed that rule really fast.
Yeah.
Oh, but was it one of those things where it's like, it's not specified?
Yeah, exactly.
Otherwise?
Yeah, yeah. It was a loophole.
And when you go back to sparking, like into the late 80s, early 90s, teams were running titanium blocks on the very outside edges of their front wings because they were, again, back then, purposely making them bend. As the car goes faster, the wing bends down closer.
Right. Oh, right? God damn.
And that would, the titanium blocks on the ends would protect it from scraping. But
let's go back to the F1 cars, though. The picture with all the rest of the cars that are there.
And actually, just you mentioning that, if you go up to the Red Bull one more time, you can't really see in this picture, but the two front mirrors there, at least on the first day, they had a infrared. Yeah.
Well, that's what they want you to do. They want you to not be able to see it.
They don't want you to be able to see it.
Oh, wait. Is this one here? One of these?
Yeah.
Okay.
Inside of those were a lens on each one pointed at the front wheels, which was most likely an infrared camera, which was probably looking at the air blowing through that blown wheel nut.
Right.
But you can't see it in this picture, and I don't know if they ran it on day two or three, but day one for sure, each of those rear mirrors had probably infrared cameras.
Wait, is that illegal?
During testing, you can test whatever.
Testing, you can do whatever. You see things like these air rakes where they put these big like wind arrays on the outside of the car.
Right.
Just to see like where the air is going.
Yeah, anyway. Okay.
You'll see like a big, almost like a shark fin. See that shark fin there?
Even this thing here?
That's for testing.
Oh, shit.
It's just like a more accurate like GPS, so like they can know exactly where he's going.
Okay.
Yeah, and how he's approaching a corner and whatever.
Yeah, see the you got an antenna sticking out of it.
Oh, and if you're curious, like these two things and the in this protrusion here, for example, and actually this top part that all the cars pretty much have, that's just there for the rules, but not for safety. It's just so they can fit cameras in there.
Yeah. Okay.
That's for the that's
for, or for like press
for,
and
for
stuff.
our view right, pressure. Right.
So during the race, you see the onboards and
yeah
replays and things like that. Yeah.
Toro Rosso.
It's another Red Bull.
Yeah, this is the second Red Bull team, but okay. It's based out of Italy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Crazy.
So, Toro Rosso.
So at one point, this Italian team basically like went up for sale. They bought it and they like used this team to basically be their junior team to try things out and to have some ideas and to have some drivers there that are going to be eventually like either move up to Red Bull or, you know, bring new talent to the sport.
They brought three drivers up through there now, right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's a good program that they have, and it's obviously like generated them some success, you know, four world championships. But now they are looking actually, well, it's been in talks for a long time, but they are looking into possibly selling this team out. If you look at the front wing, though, so you see it's very flat. It's kind of like a...
Almost like a spoon or like some sort of butter knife.
Yeah, like a diving board, yeah. Almost like thing.
A little bit like the Sauber.
No, it's more, well, it's very similar actually to the Ferrari.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah, the diamond that we haven't seen yet.
Diamondish shape.
Yeah, well, I mean,
clearly a little different than
Red Bull for sure.
The Southern Red Bull,
the works team. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's different. Yeah, so they want to try different things.
Totally.
They are running the same engine though, and you can see that like, but it's kind of packaged the same way as the Red Bull.
Very tight at the back.
Yeah. Not much to say. Oh, this team. The other noteworthy thing that I find about them is that they actually are the youngest F1 pairing in history.
Oh, yeah.
Because
shit.
This team has actually a 17-year-old is going to be driving it.
No
now,
way.
Obviously, that was allowed. They let that fly, but now they've changed the rules so that nobody under 18 can drive an F1 car. But yeah,
adults only.
Yeah. I mean, come on, this is a serious sport.
Yeah.
No kids allowed.
Yeah, but see,
should be in high school, man. Come on.
Yeah, for real.
I was learning English back then.
Yeah,
etc. Doing my fucking homework.
So that's Max Verstappen. Yeah. He's 17-year-old, and then Carlos Sainz Jr. Yeah. Or how he actually prefers to be called Carlitos Sainz, because he doesn't want the junior. So he's like, I'm Carlitos.
I'm a man.
Like,
I'm 17 years old.
Yeah,
I'm
well,
a man.
He's 20, but yeah.
Okay.
Carlitos. But Carlitos itself in Spanish, the Ito is it would be like saying little in English. So little Carlos.
It's like having a Coronita.
Yeah.
One of those mini Mexican beers.
Yeah. So he's
that's
so
this
he's
guy. That's him.
Carlitos Sainz. Carlitos signs on the wheel.
Oh my god.
Yeah. Get rid of Carlitos. Let's move on to the American.
Surprising amount of Mexicans in Formula One now.
He's Spanish.
Oh, is he?
Yeah.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, his dad, Carlos Sainz Sr., he was a 2-time world rally champion.
Yeah.
For Spain though.
Yeah, I knew his dad was a racer.
The Merc advancement on last year's concept. They don't have much to change.
Kicking so much ass.
Yeah, they went to the testing days, Mike, and on testing, cars do like 20, 30 laps, 40 laps, whatever, right?
Yeah.
Just to test different things. These guys went flat out from the beginning. The first day, Rosberg, he's the driver in the car right now, did 157 laps.
157. That's like three races.
Almost
three race lengths.
Yeah. Oh, to the amazement of the press. I mean, they left everybody with their jobs, with their jaws stuck to the floor, because nobody does that during testing. Nobody goes full out, but clearly they were trying to test reliability. So they're doing high fuel runs, reliability, like, you know, to test what would happen during an actual race situation. So I think that they're getting maybe the most useful data of all the teams, but they have the luxury of doing that because they completely destroyed last year. So Mercedes, good on them. They adopted for sort of what Lotus has done, and it's take the nose regulation as far back as possible this year.
Right. I see.
You know what I mean? Like
actually, not as far back.
Well, not as far back, but I mean, I guess within recent.
It's surprising, you know.
Yeah.
They get the most money, all that prize money we talked about last week.
Yeah. Also, clearly, like they figure that there's not that much to gain to like make it all the way back, but still, that's pretty far back.
It's interesting how big those front ears are, the camera ears there.
No, it's because apparently they've been using them. They managed a way to use these things for aero advantage now.
It looks all sort of like a airplane like, wings, like that.
Yeah, yeah. So and they've done like all kinds of crazy things. One another episode, like we'll focus just on their suspension, and it's ridiculous.
Yeah,
like it is really ridiculous what they've done here. A good car. I mean, they're only looking to make a good car better, so improve on a good product, kind of like the Williams. So obviously, a lot hasn't changed that much, but it's enough to, I'm sure, like make a difference once the race comes.
Well, you know what? Hamilton's at, I think, a fair disadvantage to Rosberg already. Like he interviewed yesterday at the end of testing. He said the car is mostly an evolution. He said it obviously has more downforce. He's got his exact same steering wheel and seat in there from last year. But they had problem yesterday. Hamilton only got 91 laps in, whereas day one and three combined, Rosberg got 308 laps in, more than triple. It's like, it's crazy.
Yeah,
he's got triple the amount of laps in this car. It's,
and actually, interesting thing is that
There's no way he's gonna give Hamilton a seat for the next test. He's gonna get all his own time, right?
Well, and Rosberg was there on the Sunday. Then Hamilton did the Tuesday, and then Rosberg, I guess, is back today.
Right.
But all of Tuesday, like the entire time that Lewis was out there in the car, Rosberg was in the pit lane with his headphones on, listening to everything, analyzing everything. And if there is one thing that Rosberg said, is that he said that he spent the entire break going through what he did and going through what happened race by race, analyzing everything. He's learning, and he has a bit of a reputation for being out of Lewis and him. He's the thinking man. He's a smart guy, and
I think he speaks six languages almost all crazy. Fluently.
Yeah. He's crazy smart, and he's banking on the fact that maybe Lewis peaked last year just on raw talent. Because in terms of raw talent, Lewis definitely has more. He's more of a natural born racer. But he's banking on maybe Lewis having sort of plateaued and reached a level, and maybe he can, just by studying, he can go above that. Now that's a tall order, but for sure.
I don't think so. We're gonna talk about some Pirelli numbers in a minute that I think might disprove that, but I guess we'll have to see going into the season. But I don't know, that front nose. Very narrow. The pylons there, if you see this car from a front view, those two pylons are incredibly narrow. Yeah. And these are the guys that have the 8-element front wing. It's incredibly complex, especially when you see that from the front.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Yeah, I don't know.
Now,
I think these guys are...
say it with me. Ferrari.
Nah.
With Vettel at the wheel.
Surprised, though. I'm going to let you talk to these guys for 1 second.
Look at that car. That car looks badass.
I'm going to piss myself, and this is your favorite shit.
That car looks badass. And I'm not much of a Vettel fan. But
I agree it looks badass, but nothing too much more special than anything else. And I didn't mind the platypus last year like everybody else.
Wow. Yeah, this thing here?
No, well, last year they had a horrible nose.
Oh, really?
So,
according to you, pull it up.
No, we're not talking. We're not gonna talk about that. Let's talk about this. Let's talk about the future.
It looks like a fucking platypus.
Right now, it's more like a
last year.
Yeah, last year they definitely did, but now it's more again like they went for the diving board look and the nose. It's more of a plank. It really sticks out far, perhaps further out. So okay, even pull up the Mercedes. So look at how far back that goes.
Yeah,
compared to the Ferrari, all the way
it
over
really
here.
Sticks
like
out.
maybe they're banking on this, so that if it's like a photo finish,
right?
Like just. There'll be centimeters ahead.
So this This one here, this... Yeah.
That's part of the wing, yeah.
That's part of the wing. Now, does that have to be... is that the same distance as this? Or is it supposed to?
No.
Do you know what I'm trying to get at? Like...
The wings can only go so far, and okay. like teams try to maximize that.
Okay.
So this part here is gonna be the, like at the same distance as that.
Okay, but from, this like, part. The so this part here.
Yeah.
Coming down. Mm-hmm. This doesn't matter. Oh. Like this can go as far as it wants.
Yeah, pretty much. Well, actually, there are some limits to that. But right. yeah, what they have to satisfy is that what I was telling you. They have to satisfy a cross section at one point. So that point for the Ferrari would be more like over here.
Okay.
There are 3 points this year.
Yeah.
It's something like 50 and 150 millimeters back or something.
Yeah. Oh, shit.
From the nose. Yeah. And the nose itself.
So clearly
actually, there's three.
Clearly up here, Mercedes like satisfied that cross section very close to where their nose ended.
Yeah.
And Ferrari just went like all the way out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
So, oh, I see.
So okay. Part of it is that it has to meet the crash structure requirements.
Right.
So okay. they might be trying to save weight or but also maybe ballast the front. Or
last year...
It's basically like a honeycomb inside there.
Ferrari got a new designer for their car, mm-hmm. James Allison. He's very well respected. A lot of people say that he's going to be like the next Adrian Newey, who is... you know,
if he lives that long, man, when you see that guy, it looks like he hasn't slept in weeks.
Yeah,
he looks tired, man.
But it's because he's been working flat out. And Ferrari, pretty much last year, they when they noticed that their car was going to be pretty much a write off because Ferrari didn't do much last year,
yeah,
they started focusing all their efforts on this year's car and this year's engine. And they've really done quite a bit. Like you can see, like, these ears here, they're kind of like the Mercedes that was very successful for them. This area here with the nose and the way that everything goes into the back, mm-hmm. apparently that's very James Allison. It has his signature all over it. Very tightly packaged. The Ferrari engine is being pretty successful, and you can see that by the runs that that the other Ferrari team. So it's
again sandbagging.
Yeah, it could be sandbagging.
Like
for
Hamilton
sure.
said yesterday that Mercedes hasn't got anywhere near full power run.
Mm. Right. Yeah, so nobody knows. And also, I mean, Ferrari or Vettel has been clocking like the fastest times, or had been for the first 2 days. But so again, today, meaningless.
Today, right. Sauber ran the fastest, but they are running
the full
Ferrari drivetrain.
Yeah. And so I mean, lots to come, I'm sure, for the for this Ferrari.
Literally 0.2005 seconds between Ferrari and Sauber today.
I found it very interesting too that they have now right at the back an Alfa Romeo badge.
Yeah, that's new.
Yeah, that is new. So Alfa Romeo is not one of their sponsors, obviously, because Alfa Romeo is under the Fiat umbrella. And even though Ferrari is going to be spun off out of Fiat, they're actually not going to do apparently a full spin out. Like apparently they're still going to control a little part of Ferrari. So maybe they're trying to promote the Alfa Romeo badge, but that maybe also is a throwback to maybe the old days, because Enzo Ferrari, when he started competing in Formula One, what he did is he competed with Alfa Romeo cars. Mm-hmm. He basically took a couple of Alfa Romeo cars, kind of redid the engine, souped them up and whatever, and put a Ferrari badge on it. But there were Alfas that he was racing at the very beginning. So maybe, I mean, there's a historical factor to it. Maybe there's the factor that they want to push the Alfa brand now, because I think Alfa Romeos are going to start to sell again in North America. Or at least they definitely want to bring the 4C back, or they want to bring the 4C to North America, but maybe also like some of like the more common road cars. And I like the idea of Alfa Romeo. Like Alfa Romeo is like a brand that just sounds cool, and they're cool looking cars.
I actually had a friend in high school I haven't seen in years. This guy Andrew, and his dad was a mechanic, mm-hmm. and him and his brother both had RX-7s that they had, like he had a proper shop that they had stripped down on a rotisserie and built them back to new. And his dad drove around in an Alfa Romeo from the 50s. It was he brought it to my house one time. That wooden steering wheel.
Yeah, man, these guys are like
old leather seats, convertibles, a 2-seater.
Wow,
small car. It was badass, man. I couldn't tell you the model because I saw it when I was probably 15 years old.
Interesting thing, though.
A long time, but
Alfa Romeos are actually also like they have a bit of a fame. Yeah. Let's be honest. They have a bit of a reputation for being anything but reliable. Like when you set off to go to a meeting or to whatever in an alpha, your preoccupation is not when will I get there, but will I get there?
Or in how many pieces will I get there? Yeah.
Lots of buzz around this Ferrari so far. I think, so how many laps did Raikkonen do?
Yesterday? Today? Yeah. 92. Today. Which is...
So it's still pretty high up there.
Fourth highest. These guys had the biggest launch, though. They're obviously excited. They did a big YouTube thing. They got Raikkonen to talk 5 minutes to the camera.
That's a lot.
Vettel did 5 minutes as well. Vettel looks... You were right, man. He looks skinnier. You can see it in his... Yeah, he almost looks like he got sick or something.
Well, he's a father now.
That's true. Maybe a bit of
stress. And so is Raikkonen, I guess.
Yeah. They released a lot of info with this car, too. Probably too much. They got Allison talked for 10 minutes about it.
Yeah, did you see? Okay, I watched you know what? That James Allison interview for Ferrari, the one that's related to their car launch, is pretty informative.
That's where he looks the most tired. Yeah. That's where I'm talking
about. Probably been working nonstop since last year.
Actually, I guess if you look at the front suspension, I was obviously wrong.
Oh, the pole road.
Ferrari sold theirs.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But in the photos for this, though, I guess, I don't know, I haven't seen the back of this car on track, but in the photos in the back, they had the diffuser was covered up with a piece of black wood.
Always do that for the release pictures. Then nobody wants to release what their big diffuser plans are going to be.
Yeah, their MGUH, they had a lot of problems with last year where they weren't during the race. I think during qualifying, they got up there. I don't think they ever got in the top three, but they were making enough power, electrical power, for qualifying. But for the race, their harvesting wasn't enough. And I think that's one of their big points that they made this year, is that they've improved their electrical system this year.
Okay.
Can handle more current. The batteries can handle more power. And
crazy.
They believe their boost for the races is going to be higher. It's kind of too complicated to really get into, but...
Yeah, I'm already lost.
Yeah, it's but anyways, this was their main problem last year, which is according to them being resolved. I don't know. Seems that way. This is the only team
you're probably the classiest man I know.
Get a bottle of wine.
Since we're talking about Italy. I gotta fix my table. It's so wobbly.
It's not.
You guys are so animated, especially you, Jay. Look,
it's not wine and it's not from Italy. Actually, you know how I've taken to bringing you guys some gifts the last couple of podcasts.
You just get us drunk every time we do that.
So my gift to you guys, because we're talking about Jerez de la Frontera, is.
Where did that come from?
Some sherry from Jerez.
Oh, my God.
From where the Formula One is having the testing right now. Actually,
you're gonna drink like Frasier.
Yeah. So
that was his favorite shit on that show. Niles, pour us some sherry.
No, this stuff is really good, actually. And actually, the name for like sherry in Spanish is Jerez.
Oh, okay.
Because the best sherry in Spain comes from Jerez. So Jerez is known for their sherry, and this is very, you go to Jerez to have sherry. So let's try some Jerez from Jerez.
Oh, that's awesome.
Beautiful. So I believe the roll hoop on this car, I think, is the only triangle one. The shape there is like a triangle, which is, I don't know if you don't know, above the driver's head there.
We
should have got head-on pictures, but maybe we will do this again after the third test, after all the cars evolve a little bit.
They're definitely going to change some pieces and bits. And obviously, one thing, Mike, all of this, the way that the cars start at the beginning of the year, it's going to look like some parts are going to look completely different by the end of the year, sure. And that's the thing about F1, right? Like, there's this, and then there's the racing that happens in at each race, and then there's the development race, which is that each team is trying to improve parts every single weekend, and every single weekend they bring new parts, and obviously some teams more than others, but yeah, we'll definitely see some changes in these cars. But right now, from the way that they look right now, obviously this is going to be the basic shape. And from this we can say a lot, but it's not definite.
Another thing I noticed about this car is if you look at the back.
Cheers.
Chin chin.
Salud.
Chin chin. if you look at the backs of these cars, the I think particularly the Ferrari monkey seat is high. It's like really, it seems like it's sitting really high, and it's got a double element to it.
And it's and it, and it's coming from sort of the back of the car as opposed to like the bottom.
Yeah,
yeah, it's pretty cool. It's kind of like it looks like it's floating
it's
almost.
Mounted differently.
Yeah, yeah.
It seems like it's really gonna catch a lot of exhaust. But yeah, like last year, man, going into Australia, getting close, man. Was it six more weeks? Seven more weeks?
Mid March,
six more weeks. Last year, there was so much speculation that like half the field wasn't gonna finish the first race, and towards the end of the year, we almost had some records broken. So,
even right now, man. Okay, so I'm glad that you brought that up because I looked up what the testing results were from last year.
Yeah, and we looked at this just before the show.
Yeah, so last year, for day one, the fastest time was Raikkonen on the Ferrari, 127.104. And this year, what? Like, so it was Vettel did. If you go to the timings, Mike up there,
122.6.
Should be like all the way over there.
Ferrari 122.
Yeah, that was the first one. Yeah. So, oh no,
120.9.
So that's the second day.
7 seconds.
Sunday. That's the first day. So it was so Vettel 122. So already faster. Now for day two. So the Monday, the fastest time last year was Button on the McLaren 124.165. So already like so what 3 seconds faster? Vettel going 129.984. Yeah, in that one that you had, Mike, in this one. Yeah. So Monday, like already the second day, it's already like what 4 seconds faster almost.
Yeah.
And day three, the fastest time in day three was Magnussen on the McLaren. Last year when Magnussen was driving the McLaren, 123.375. And Mike, that's in that in the BBC page here. That one. If you scroll down a little, Yeah. What is the fastest time for a little more?
A little bit more.
Yeah. Here. Yeah. So 121. Even Nasser on a Sauber, it's faster than Magnussen on the McLaren of last year. So what that tells me, I mean, even though yes, testing is irrelevant, the times that you get from them, but just overall, it gives you some speculation.
Well,
these cars are faster. They're at least going faster during testing.
Yeah.
And even actually, like, so that time, that Magnussen's time of 123.276 was the fastest time in testing period last year.
I think, and this has become a concern, I think especially towards the end of the year, a big concern for Paul Hembree, who's the Pirelli Motorsports boss. Mm. Yeah, if you look at your numbers there, the first day, Ferrari last year, Raikkonen, 127.1. Today, Raikkonen's first time in the Ferrari, 121.7.
Yeah.
But if you compare him, though, to Vettel yesterday, again, it's testing, so you got to see him side by side. But Vettel is 0.8 seconds faster. But that was also his second day in the car. Did a lot more laps. I don't know. It's going to be an exciting year. We got one more day of testing to go. Probably nothing crazy happening tomorrow.
Yeah, and
final tests before. I mean, head back to the factories.
Today, it started raining a little, right? And they are saying that maybe it's gonna be a little bit of that
too at the end of the day. No.
Yeah. So.
Well, at least they got to test the wets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true. Actually, no. Yeah, it was yesterday. It started raining. Either way. So what else we got? For the actual days of testing.
Well, we saw on two of those cars we just looked at, they have the new super soft tires.
Right, so yeah, the development tires.
Yeah, what happened was Pirelli's...
At the end?
Pirelli's big mandate was to... which really they hit almost all of their goals, was they wanted... Yeah, that's a photo of an array of this year's tires, more or less. Mm-hmm. It's probably two sets missing. You see the black ones at the top.
Those aren't marked because they're development tires.
Those are development tires. They're not 100% finalized, but most likely that's what they're going to be. The Super Soft this year, they've changed the construction and the composition. Whereas I believe all the other tires, they've changed the composition. So just talking about last year's testing versus this year's, they've gotten like 7 seconds faster, maybe 15%, almost 20% faster. 15%
Blackberry. Faster.
Yeah, that's it. Mercedes has a BlackBerry sponsorship.
Yeah. The fuck? What?
Yeah, they do. Yeah. At the start of the year, they changed all the tires last year as well, going with this new formula. There's a lot more torque in these engines because of the electric motors. And at the start of the year, they were kind of conservative tire choices that they were lasting a long time. But towards the end of the year was when records started to be broken. There were actually zero fastest race laps set last year. Rosberg himself had the most personal fastest. But the only tire they completely changed this year was the Super Soft. I'm not sure why. But before we get into this year's tires, I want to see if anyone remembers the April test last year. And actually, I want to send you one more picture I have here. I should have sent you earlier. Have you seen this before?
No.
Jay?
No.
So in April, I believe April 4th was the test last year. Maybe in Bahrain. I'm not 100%. I'm forgetting now. But at that time, it was set that this year, the tire blankets were to be banned. I didn't know this. You can pull up that picture now. Did you know this?
Did that go through?
No. This is what happened. So those there were tested last year.
Right. Well, that was the 18-inch wheels, right?
So they tested these 18-inch wheels. And the big thing with the tire blankets, you've seen them,
yeah,
Mike?
Yeah.
So what they do is, with these tires now, is they want them as hot as possible. They want that rubber soft. They want the tire hot. And the thing is, you put air in these tires. There's a minimum PSI that Pirelli sets.
Right.
Because two years ago, we saw a bunch of actually delaminations, mm-hmm. which is
where like the top layer of the tire just
peeled off.
Jesus Christ. Like,
actually, in the opening credits on Sky, they show where basically, I think it was Alonso almost got killed by one of those.
Yeah, something like that.
Jesus.
Yeah. There was a tire husk went like inches from his head, man. Like this thing delaminated. And there was a few big accidents. So what happens is, as these tires heat up, the pressure builds. So the teams want to start them on as low a pressure as possible. So it gives you more grip to keep the tire as low pressured as possible once it heats up. But the problem with getting rid of the blankets is the temperature difference would be so big that volume of air in the smaller rim will expand so much that they're afraid they'll balloon or bubble or cause bumps or rips. So probably it's going to be next year.
The
18-inch tires. Because actually, I don't know if people know this, GP2, for anyone that doesn't follow it, got rid of tire blankets.
Oh, yeah?
But according to Ferrari, Paul Hembree...
Pirelli.
Well, Paul Hembree is the Pirelli boss.
Oh, motorsport.
The motorsport boss, yeah. He's sort of like the face as well. His concern was that you can't just switch to these tires. It's such a big change. It's going to take a year or two. So I think these 18-inch wheels are safe, but enough of the teams weren't ready yet. They're going to run one more year with the blankets.
Okay.
But they tested those last year. Only one dude got to actually drive them.
Wasn't there a Lotus? Like, I think it was Grosjean did that, and I don't remember.
I don't remember, man. Yeah. It was Charles Peak for Lotus.
Oh, right.
Yeah, he said his quote was that it affected handling and aerodynamics especially quite a lot. Mm. So this is going to go, I think, next year alongside the aggressive look, fatter wings, fatter rear tires.
I do like the way that the 18-inch rims look. And actually, the thing is that these tires...
I don't give a shit about any aesthetics.
Yeah.
Personally, I don't.
I do, man. You go out to the track and you watch these cars on TV and like... I mean, yeah, it's their main point is not to look good for me. It's to go faster on the track and whatever. Yeah. But it is nice when they look badass. When cars look cool, it's that much better.
Running these tires is going to require aerodynamics overhaul, though.
For sure.
Especially with the three teams this year, I think Ferrari as well, running the blown wheel nuts. Mm-hmm. And you know other teams are going to be developing that.
Oh, yeah.
Moving into the season. So basically, I don't know, GP2 has no blankets. I don't know, this is Pirelli's fifth year. in the sport.
They've been doing all right. I mean, it's better than whatever they had before. The Bridgestone tires competing with Michelin.
Yeah. It's cars sponsored by different teams. But basically, they've hit their mandate. Their mandate was to average through the season 2 pit stops per driver per race. They averaged 2.02, which is pretty incredible. 817 total pit stops. They released an infographic here. We're not going to go through the whole thing.
Yeah, it's a bit, right?
It's a bit dry.
Let me get a sip of this. I've been talking.
A bit dry, this sherry.
Every time. Oh, wow. Yeah, like, I drink it, I get shivers.
Yeah, it's like,
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm, Tio Pepe.
Yeah, it's a little bit...
Not my favorite, but apparently I heard that I was talking to the girl at the LC, because what I was gonna do is I was gonna bring this and make cocktails with it, and she was like, oh, you know, just have it like it is, like it is a bit of a distinctive taste, and I was like,
I can taste it in the back of my nose.
Yeah, but then after that she told me that, like, she was hanging out with her friends and they were making Caesars with this instead of vodka.
And what's the percentage on that?
15.
15?
Yeah.
Nothing crazy. Yeah. Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
Okay, at this Bahrain test last year, they're getting ready for this. The tires proved safe, but I think Pirelli at the time wasn't ready to commit to the blanket. They tested at that time eight new compositions, 6 different compounds. It's like basically the shape of the tire. 6 compounds, what the rubber is made of, 200 total tires, 250 total tires, 110 laps total with Caterham and Williams.
These tires, man, like, they from beginning to end, Pirelli, it takes him about 6 months to make a tire.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck.
Anyone that's interested, go on YouTube and watch. It's probably from about 3 years ago now, 3-4 years ago, but...
It's still kind of current. I mean, they still do the same thing. So they build
more or less the same tires now, yeah.
They're building with this, like, specialized facility that they have in Turkey, and it's crazy. There's just in these tires, and they do just... I mean, it's not that they look simple, but you just by looking at them, you wouldn't tell that there's so much that goes into them, man.
Yeah.
It's pretty crazy. Yeah. Other stuff that happens during testing, though, is that teams try to see, because they have these computers, right?
Yeah.
And they run these very complicated programs, CFD, that tells them how the aerodynamics are supposed to work in theory, but when it comes to practice, obviously everything is a little different. So they spray paint these cars, they spray paint this car with this paint. They call it Flovis, and you can see here in this picture it's green.
Yeah.
And basically what it does is that once the cars go around at speed, the paint runs off and it shows them where the air is actually moving.
Crazy.
So you can see how maybe this paint wasn't all here before, right? This green, but then eventually from running it got so you can see the airflow, like, whoa, souping up.
Oh, cool.
And it tells a lot about if they're going in the right direction either aerodynamically.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, we don't have to go back, but on that picture we looked at with the 6 cars from the top side view,
yeah,
there was a separate Flovis picture of the Mercedes, and I believe the Williams had some blue Flovis. You don't see it as much, but I think it probably didn't work too much or well, or it was
the UV one.
Yeah, about two and three years ago, they were running, because they'll do this on weekend practice sessions, like the first or second practice, spray it on the front wing or the back wing, and
right
if they're testing a new wing that's specifically for that race. But yeah, they were using some UV Flovis, which was basically invisible.
Just so other teams couldn't see.
Yeah.
Oh, what?
Or the cameras.
It didn't work very well.
The TV cameras.
Oh, okay.
It must have been too much of a pain in the ass to, like, go with a black light and try to take pictures and all that. Didn't work out.
This is pretty cool. And throughout the season, Mike, and if we sit down and actually watch the races, you'll see, like, during the testing sessions of the race, they will show some cars, like, with the Flovis, and, like, you can see the lines of the aerodynamic going.
Oh, that's cool.
And what you want is, like, nice, neat flow, right? Okay. As soon as you have, like, little vortices forming, that's not as beneficial.
Right.
So, yeah, definitely we're going to see a lot of this. No.
Before we go on, hold on. I got a little bit more about Mercedes and these tires. Anyone that's interested, also, if you go to Pirelli.com, they just put out in the last few days like a gigantic infographic yeah. about all the numbers, like numbers you couldn't even imagined about last year. But I just want to make a quick comparison between Hamilton and Rosberg, because they break down the six types of tires. So I don't know if you know this. They got super soft, soft, medium, hard.
Yeah.
As the four dry tires. And then there's the intermediate for light rain and a full wet tire.
Okay.
Which it last year didn't get used very much at all. If we go to the top here, I'll actually break this down. There were 38,168 tires supplied last year throughout the competitive season. 26,000 slicks, 11, just under 12,000 rain tires, 32,000 for racing, 5,000 for testing.
This is for F1.
Just for F1.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Every single one was recycled. So that's good to know. And actually, of those 38,000, 12,744 were not used. They were delivered to the track. We try to figure this out just like sitting around drunk talking before. How many fucking tires are there for the weekend? Like,
yeah,
that's a lot, dude.
Pirelli's job is to choose the sets for the weekend. Like sometimes they'll split it, so it'll be like the hard and the soft tire will be like they'll separate them.
Yeah.
Depending on the track. Their job is to pick, but they have to send at least 6 or 8 sets for each team, like for all three testing.
Right.
2 each for the race, whatever the limit is for the race. Mm-hmm. And then full sets of intermediate and wet in case it rains.
Yeah.
Oh, it's crazy, God. Man. There's hundreds of tires.
Part of the strategy, and I mean, we'll get into it. Like, not that you need to know it yet, but yeah. We'll get into it as the race weekend progresses. You'll get into a situation where maybe some teams forego, like, say, either going out and doing some laps during testing or going out and doing some laps during qualifying because they want to save the tires for the race.
Okay.
So honestly, I love Pirelli. They've changed the sport for the better. Their mandate, like I said, average 2 pit stops per driver per race, increase overtaking, 636 overtakes this year, 33 average race. Sorry, yeah, last year, 2014.
Jesus.
And to create diverse strategy options, like Jay just said, mm-hmm. with the tires, some teams will run 1 pit stop or some mm-hmm. will run 2, some will run 3, depending on the tire split. But anyways, let's get back to Hamilton and Rosberg here, because what you said about Rosberg studying Hamilton's moves,
yeah.
trying to be more like him. He was faster through the year. He broke.
During qualifying,
He out-qualified everybody. For the fastest laps, he got 11 fastest qualifyings, 5 fastest races this year. But the thing is, the highest number of laps in the lead was Hamilton at 495.
Oh,
but
yeah.
The most interesting here is the breakdown of who did the most kilometers per tire type.
Okay. And who?
So if we start with the super soft, we got Perez did 2,846. Going too soft.
Yeah, I guess they did a lot of really long stints on the super soft with Checo.
I think, I don't know. I guess whatever, their downforce was balanced enough that they use those tires more. Gutierrez on the soft, 7,000. And on the hard, Bottas got the most at 3,544. But what's interesting is the medium, intermediate, and wet are all held by Hamilton.
Really?
8,230 laps on the mediums, 1,142 on the intermediate, and 469 on the wet. The wet wasn't really used a whole lot. It was used a lot in China and maybe one other race. Yeah. I don't know. But, so Hamilton, obviously,
Malaysia, it didn't rain. It was supposed to rain, but it didn't rain.
Yeah, actually. They were expecting a monsoon there. Yeah. As Japan, obviously.
Yeah. What do we say? That's true.
That was the wet race. Yeah. That was the wet race. But yeah, obviously Hamilton's got the balance, right? He's got the style down. He's keeping his tires fresh. He's got the most laps in the lead by far. And Rosberg got some fastest laps. And I think, so now the reason for the change this year from the start of the year is that these tires were super conservative. And going towards the end of the year.
Yeah, they want to throw in like something else that would shuffle the pack along.
Right. But there were actually zero race lap records broken last year.
Yeah.
But
we knew that the cars were, in 2014 were going to be slower overall. But we knew that.
The thing is, like...
Actually, no.
Paul Henry said...
No. Didn't they break the record for Brazil?
Yes. That's what I was just going to say. The first record was broken at the second last race. Rosberg had the fastest pole of all time at that track.
But it's because, okay, so Brazil got resurfaced.
That is true.
And because they were higher up, in years prior with the naturally aspirated V6 or V8, they lost power when going at such a high altitude. Right. With the turbos, though, that they didn't suffer from that because the turbo could just pack up as much air as there is.
And the thing was, what Paul Hembree said, one of his quotes was that, like, Pirelli was surprised by the end of the season that the tires were getting close to the edge of what they were designed for.
Nice.
That's why they've been hard. That's why they've been hardened this year.
Nice.
And the super softs were used 6 times last year, which is up there. It's one of the most used tires. That one's been completely changed. But they're expecting a lot faster cars this year. Basically, like,
Mercedes has said... You can see that already from testing.
Mercedes has said on record they suspect they had 60 horsepower hidden.
Just like that, yeah.
Just ready to
release. They said that at the end of last year. So right. Who knows what they found like since. You know what I mean?
Yeah, since then. Exactly.
It's going to be an exciting year despite everything that is wrong with this sport, which is a lot.
I don't know, man. It's going to be a good year. It's going to be full of sparks.
Green bits. I'm excited about the green bits.
Yeah. We got... all the green bits from last year.
Yeah. No. Wait. What is this tab here? Oh yeah. Check it. Okay. So remember we were looking at the
couple more quick things.
The steering wheel. So I guess this is a Mercedes steering wheel. By the looks of it, it looks like a like this is Nico Rosberg's steering wheel.
Yeah, cause Hamilton said yesterday he's actually running. Who knows if he'll race with it, but he's running the same.
Yeah, this looks exactly the same as last year. So in that regard, they haven't changed. But Red Bull does look like they're finally running
They're running the screen now.
Yeah, the screen. Yeah,
the full LCD.
Yeah. So I just wanted to point out that from last year to this year, maybe the steering wheels may not be changing that much. But it's probably because there's no new bits to add. Like, there's no new DRS or anything like that. So the buttons are still essentially the same.
Yeah, all the buttons should be the same.
Yeah. You can move on to the next one, Mike.
Should we move back one picture first?
Okay. Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. You found this, Danny, and this is hilarious.
This was yesterday. I saw this in the morning. About 2:10 a.m. Who knows what time zone he's in, actually. That's probably our time zone.
British.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, maybe he might be at the track. He might be at Jerez. You never know. He's not like he has a job right now.
Yes, that's true.
That's where I'd be if I had his money. Anyways, Max Chilton on Twitter at Max Chilton, his most recent tweet. I've woken up feeling like something is missing, comma. It's an F1 car in motion with the crisp morning air rushing under my visor.
Jesus.
Hashtag God. Still hoping.
No, get out. This guy was never going to
make
it.
It's not happening,
back.
Dude.
Yeah. He's sorry, man.
This was a guy, if you don't know, he's got a rich dad.
Mm.
Bought his way in. Mm. His team is now owned by Gene Haas.
The facilities. The factory.
The factory, the facilities, equipment. Computers, blah, blah, blah. We'll talk about Gene Haas. I said this week.
There ain't no way Gene Haas is going to have another Brit driving that damn car.
America. You know it's going to be somebody from America.
Yeah.
But he said, we'll get into Gene Haas next week because there's a lot of shit going on right now. But
yeah,
he said he's in no rush to be hiring any drivers.
Mm. Yeah.
But they've actually started aero testing this week in Italy. But yeah, we'll get into Haas next week.
Oh.
What do you got?
we already saw that.
We talked about this.
Next one. This is a great picture that Tobias Grüner posted.
Actually, Ted's talk too. They kind of snuck past.
No, yeah. So basically, okay. So go to the left. So basically, what was happening here is that they managed to like go in and because
tell Mike who these three dudes are since.
Right, yeah. So that's Niki Lauda.
That's who was we were looking
at. This guy in the back here in the red hat?
That's the dude who's taking a piss.
Yeah, he's,
oh,
a, he's a
awesome.
Elderly
he's
F1 fan. But also, okay, so back in the day, he used to be a racer. He's, he again, like one of the sports greats.
Right.
But
if you saw Rush,
yeah.
The dude whose ear burned off.
Yeah. His face is still kind of fucked. But anyway, he is the executive. He's he holds an executive position in Mercedes, in the team Mercedes team right now.
Actually, he is the non-executive chairman.
No, he moved to executive now. This year. Yeah, he used to be non-executive, but he's executive.
That's an embarrassing title to have to say.
Yeah,
it's like it's like back in The Office with Michael Scott and what's his name? Oh my God, Dwight Schrute. He always said he was the assistant. Assistant director, whatever.
He's the assistant trailer park supervisor.
Assistant.
And weekend trailer park supervisor.
Assistant to the president.
Forgot, Frick.
and that is the Totonator.
Okay.
his name is, well, actually, that's not his name, but he calls himself Toto Wolf. Or Wolf.
Well, his mother does.
Yeah, well, I guess so. So Toto Wolf, he is basically the one of the main guys on Mercedes.
Professional Arnold Schwarzenegger impersonator.
Oh, for sure.
Oh,
he sounds exactly like the Governator, and that's why they call him the Totonator. And or I call him the Totonator. I'm sure people don't call him the Totonator to his face, but
because he'd eat you.
Yeah, he basically like. So what's going on right now? There. they're negotiating the deal for Lewis Hamilton. Lewis Hamilton, he won the championship last year.
This guy here?
Yeah. So he's a racer. He's a current champion.
Right. He originally signed a 2-year contract with Mercedes, but since he won the fucking championship last year.
He went and ditched his management company. Right. And because, okay, so last year, but he only got them last year. That's the thing. Or you know, shortly before last year. Anyway.
I would bet that has something to do with
Drake.
His new affiliation with OVO Entertainment.
Yeah, probably. Well, now he says he's his own man. And he wants to be his own manager. And he's like, oh, I've read the contracts before, so therefore I know how to do this.
No, that makes you a lawyer.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Anyway.
He does have a lawyer.
Yeah, well, I'm sure he does. But
he's hired his management.
The thing is that what this is supposed to be is that right now they're in the middle of negotiating, and it's this deal obviously has to be finalized before the racing starts.
Right.
Yeah. So apparently what happened is that Toto Wolff went there and scribbled a number down. And like, kind of like, slid it off the table, like, you know, like, you know what I mean, one of those, like, in like TV shows or old movies, like, here, let me put this number down here. Look at it. You don't have to say yes right away.
Probably
and
that piece of paper, right?
He figured that Tobias was looking at him. He's like covering, like, no. You're not gonna see what that number is.
That camera's
is.
Got a big lens on it.
Yeah. That is too funny.
Yeah, this is a good picture. So. Of all the things that are happening around testing, this is one of them, I guess.
Yeah.
So yeah, he's hoping to negotiate a big contract.
Yeah,
There's a rumor that he's negotiating his final contract. He might not be.
Yeah.
He might retire with these guys with Mercedes.
For sure. I think that.
Look at that look.
He's like, yeah, he's like,
fuck off. this guy's like, ah. Oh,
part of the reason that he wants to stick to is that he's like a superstar. He's a celebrity now.
Right.
He thinks he is, at least.
Okay. Well, he
really, really, really wants to be like a celebrity that gets like invited to parties in LA and shit. Like he owns a house in Colorado, and he's dating Nicole Scherzinger, like the lead singer of the Pussycat Dolls. So he's been hanging out with Drake. You know what I mean? Like they're talking about like him maybe releasing a rap album.
Oh, I'm sure he'll drop a mixtape first.
Yeah. He passed the ox cord to somebody.
But he, I think, wants to stick here because, like we talked about earlier, Button was forced to shave his face.
Right.
Because of Gillette. So you think how much some teams might not want him on the radio spitting some rap tunes.
Right. Right.
Where Mercedes seems happy to let him do whatever he wants. Right?
Well, I think maybe he's negotiating like the ability to like weave in a golden chain onto his race suit. just bling up his suit altogether. Yeah, like,
I want that.
I would also want that. Yeah.
Oh man. Anyway, what else have we got here? We cannot end this podcast without announcing our next. We should have done this at the beginning.
No, but make him wait.
Make him sweat for it.
For anyone that's still listening, you want that RFM invite.
Yeah. So
we're
gonna
make it a little easier this week. You don't have to get all your pencil crayons or markers or crayons
or make a t-shirt. Even though if you do want to make a t-shirt, you're more than encouraged because somebody won just by making a t-shirt. But so if you
honestly
wanna,
dude, that t-shirt's badass.
Yeah.
Wow.
What was
Well, let's play Harrison let's Logan. Play that video one more time because it's kind of what we're looking for. Listen to this again. Turn it up. Okay. So it doesn't have to be broken.
Mike, if you had to make your best impression, I mean, even though you are a rookie to F1, a novice, if you had to make an impression of what a current F1 engine sounds like, how it go?
Okay, it goes something like, That was that one. It's just screaming into a microphone.
They kind of, but they have that turbo going on in the background. So
yeah, I know how to use that with my mouth.
It kind of sounds like.
So wait, what are you saying? What are you asking the people to do?
They're the entry requirements.
So yes, so basically, to win the next Racing for Me invite, the next RFM invite, if you're tired of your local coverage of F1 and wanna access better stuff out there, if you wanna stick your finger up to Bernie, then what you would do is you gotta get into Racing for Me. They have good quality shit there anyway. And to win the second invite that we're raffling right now, or that we're giving away, you have to imitate the 2015 F1 engines
of your choice, broken or not.
Yeah, yeah.
Whatever. Send us a video. MP3.
Obviously, you have to tell us which engine you're imitating. Yeah,
we want to hear what car it is.
Can we feature them as?
Oh
well?
Yeah. Oh, we're gonna play this. Yeah. But anyway, yeah. So you have to tell us which engine you're going for, and you have to do it. You can do it just by yourself or in tandem if you want.
Yeah, harmonize with your buddies.
Yeah, somebody does it.
Harmonize with yourself with some audio software.
Let's try it right now. Okay, so I'll do the turbo bit, and you do. Okay. You know, something like that.
Oh, that's fucking beautiful.
Box.
So do it. I know that there's several ways to do it out there. There's if you go to vocaroo.com, you can like post your audio and just send us a link, or you can send us an MP3.
Just MP3.
Upload it somewhere.
FlatOutFever@gmail.com.
Yeah, we got FlatOutFever.
@FlatOutFever on Twitter. FOF podcast on Reddit.
Right. What else?
Flat Out Fever on Reddit.
Right. Yeah. Flat Out Fever on Reddit. We're Flat Out Fever on Facebook. Where else are we? We're on Elo even. We're on Elo. Flat Out Fever Elo. On Elo.
I think that's about it.
Anyway, yeah. There's many ways. So yeah, either Reddit, whatever. Post them up. Give us a link to your imitation of of a current F1 engine. Obviously, tell us what you're going for.
Post them on Reddit. Get a comparison. Get some upvotes.
The best one definitely is gonna win the invitation. And yeah, let's hear him.
Let's hear it one more time. One more time. Congrats to fucking
Harrison Logan. Congrats for winning the first round. Second round is all up for grabs. We're gonna be doing this once a week, obviously, as you can see from the channel. And so next week we're gonna be posting it, the winner. And this is obviously gonna happen like after testing. I think we can wrap it up for today with that.
That's it, man. Harrison, thank you very much. Expect an email.
Mike? Oh, no, or a Facebook thing. Anyway, Mike, you can go ahead and...
Oh, hold on.
Play us the fuck out. Hold on, nothing.
I can
turn this show off.
Guys,
show's over.
Was,
drink this glass of Jerez.
Yeah, this is
no.
This
that's
is,
fucking
actually,
gross.
If anybody's curious as to how like what this tastes like, it is like short of awful. Yeah. This is not great.
Yeah, don't listen to the LC ever. No suggestions.
Well, no, it was you know for a reason, right?
Yeah, that's, well, yeah. There was
this something. This is a glass of Jerez.
Yeah, there we go. It is. Jerez. 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 Jerez.